take on the Bearcats of Cincinnati with Action 11 News sportscasters Dave Conrad and Paul Rogers. Tonight's game is brought to you by Bluegrass Hardware Stores. When you shop Bluegrass, you're through shopping. By Arby's Roast Beef Restaurants in Louisville. Welcome to Arby's. You're right where you belong. By Budweiser, the king of beers and proud sponsor of the U.S. Olympic team. For all you do, this Bud's for you. By Great Financial Federal, making it great for you. By American Builders. Now build a better tomorrow with American Builders. By Pepsi-Cola General Bottlers, Louisville, Kentucky. Bottlers of Pepsi-Cola, Diet Pepsi, Pepsi Free, Pepsi Light, and Mountain Dew. And by Ashland Oil. Ashland's America, where quality education is an investment we've got to make. Now to Freedom Hall and Dave Conrad with Paul Rogers.
It's college basketball time again in Louisville's Freedom Hall as the Cardinals host arch rival Cincinnati in a Metro Conference encounter. Good evening, everybody. Dave Conrad with me is Paul Rogers, and tonight we expect to see a couple of streaks extended by Louisville. Number one, their 16th consecutive win over this arch rival Cincinnati Bearcats, and with that, their 18th consecutive win in the Metro Conference, which is a league record.
That it is, and it was a record that they broke last Saturday, and the record they broke was their own. They bring a 9-4 mark overall in here against a Cincinnati team that's really struggling in their first year under Wayne Yates, getting just two wins.
2-13, Cincinnati's record. They won their opening game of the season and lost nine in a row before finally tasting victory again, but they've lost their last four. So they'll try to end that tonight against Louisville, but the Cardinals are really high after Saturday's exciting come-from-behind win here in Freedom Hall against Virginia Tech.
Louisville trailed by 9 points with about 3.5 minutes to go and pulled it out, tying and forcing it overtime and then getting the win. Denny Crum didn't necessarily think his team played all that well, but there's no doubt they played very hard, and he was very proud of the way they came back. Louisville now has blown out teams. They've been blown out. They've won some close ones and lost some close ones. They have protected close leads in the end of games, and now they have shown that they can come from behind and win. Louisville getting some clutch baskets and outside shooting from Jeff Hall, you saw there, to get the win over Virginia Tech, and one that they have proven to themselves that if they keep playing and keep plugging away, they can pull a game under the fire regardless of the circumstances. They don't like to be in that position too often, but it's nice to know you can do it if necessary.
This is going to be interesting tonight to see if Cincinnati, and you know they will want to control the tempo in this game. A week and a half ago, Louisville beat the Bearcats up in Riverfront Coliseum 51-37. We expect a slow-down game tonight from Cincinnati. They figure it's their best chance to upset Louisville.
It's the way they played everyone. I don't look for a 24-11 game like they played against Kentucky, but there's no doubt they're going to try and keep the score in the low 50s or so. If it gets up into the 60s or more, then you can consider that Louisville's doing a pretty good job of playing the game the way they want it to go.
So tonight we'll find out if the Cardinals can make it 16 in a row over Cincinnati, the starting lineup, and tonight's basketball game coming up.
This Bud's for everyone who takes on the heavy loads.
This Bud's for you. For all you do, the king of beers is coming through.
Yeah, just for you, that distinctively clean, crisp taste that says Budweiser.
For all you do, this Bud's for you.
Investing money can be a real adventure. One day you're up, the next day. At Great Financial Federal, our certificates of deposit pay a rate that's fixed for the term of the certificate, with no ups, no downs, safely, securely. So the next time you invest your money, ask yourself this. Do you want excitement, or do you want results?
Bluegrass Hardware Store.
Right now, your Bluegrass store is featuring the all-you-need kit from Formby's. Find out how easy refinishing can be, even for the beginner. Each kit contains furniture refinisher, tung oil, refinishing pads, and illustrated instructions. Formby's, it's all you need to make old look new again.
Bluegrass Hardware Stores. When you shop best, you're through shopping.
If you want something new,
introducing Arby's Real Croissant Breakfast.
Our breakfast is for you.
Light, flaky, buttery croissants.
You like to look for more.
fresh eggs, crisp bacon, sausage, ham, mushrooms, and cheese.
To you we say bonjour, so welcome to Arby's. You're right where you belong.
Arby's Real Croissant Breakfast.
The Louisville Cardinals and the Cincinnati Bearcats. And, Paul, I was just thinking this used to be, here in Freedom Hall, the highlight of the basketball season.
It really was. Back in the Missouri Valley days and the early Metro Conference years, Louisville-Cincinnati had that fierce rivalry. As we mentioned, Louisville has won 14 in a row to take the 29-18 series lead. Until then, the teams were very well evenly matched. And Cincinnati was one of the premier basketball programs in the country. Of course, Tony Yates, who's in his first year as a coach, played on two national championship teams. And Cincinnati had 25 consecutive winning seasons, including five straight Final Four appearances, until they went 13-14 in Ed Badger's first year, 78-79. But that 25 straight winning season string, I think, was the second longest going, second only to Louisville's at the time. But they had winning basketball, and then Cincinnati, just one of those things that's kind of tough to explain, suddenly fell on some hard times, and so they brought in Wayne Yates, a former player, who knows what it's like to play championship basketball, obviously, and despite the bad record this year, 2-13, I've heard nothing but good words about him. They think he can do the job. He's recruited some good players for next year. You see the Metro standings, just how Cincinnati has struggled, winless in the league, 2-13 overall. But Tony Yates doesn't like to play the style of ball he's playing this year. He's just had to resort to it because of a lack of size and a lack of talent overall. But he's not a slow-down coach. When he gets the players he wants, he'll play a more crowd-pleasing style of basketball, and hopefully the Louisville-Cincinnati rivalry will go back to where it once was, which was like what Louisville-Memphis State is now. Good rivalries are good for basketball. The fans like it, the players like it, and it's good for the league and good for the school.
But right now, Cincinnati is just going through the growing pains in trying to get the program started again. The Louisville Cardinals, meanwhile, as the co-captains, Lancaster Gordon and Charles Jones, meet the co-captains, the representatives from Cincinnati out at center court. And in just a moment, we'll have the starting lineups. I almost forgot to mention that Charles Jones has been named the Metro Conference Player of the Week for his sterling performance Saturday afternoon here in Freedom Hall against Virginia Tech. 11 points, 17 rebounds, 5 steals, 3 block shots, 2 assists, and I think he sold 6 bags of popcorn during that game, too.
That 17-rebound performance upped his average to 9.9 rebounds per game. He's trying to become the first Louisville player since Ron Thomas in the early 70s to average at least 10 rebounds a game.
It's Louisville against Cincinnati. Let's pick up the introduction of the starting lineups with John Tong.
Mark Dale. At forward for Louisville, number 55, 6'7", a sophomore from Camden, New Jersey, Billy Thompson. At forward for Cincinnati, number 40, 6'7", a junior from Carpenter, Illinois, Mike Schapansky. At forward for Louisville, number 30, 6'6", a junior from Louisville Moore, Manuel Forrest. At center for Cincinnati, number 35, 6'6", a senior from Cincinnati, Ohio, Mark Doris. And at center for Louisville, number 33, 6'8", a senior from Scuba, Mississippi, Charles Jones. At guard for Cincinnati, number 13, 6'2", a junior from Chicago, Illinois, Derek McMillan. And at guard for Louisville, number 20, 6'5", a junior from Camden, New Jersey, Milt Wagner. At guard for Cincinnati, number 15, 6'1", a junior from Toledo, Ohio, Tony Wilson. And at guard for Louisville, number 4, 6'3", a senior from Jackson, Mississippi, Lancaster Gordon.
In It's obvious from having seen the introduction of the lineups that Manuel Forrest is okay, having suffered a concussion and being knocked unconscious in the game against Virginia Tech. But Manuel spent the night in the hospital, was released, and has been practicing this week with no apparent ill effects. They say he's been going hard at it. Hasn't slowed him down at all. So Manuel in the starting lineup tonight.
He sure went hard at it in the first half before the injury Saturday against Virginia Tech. He had a great game going.
Metro Conference crew officiating tonight's game since it is a league contest.
Yeah. And they're telling us.
And the Cardinals hoping to run the winning streak to 6 for this season. Louisville has quite a size advantage tonight at every position. The tallest player on the floor is Mike Chapansky at 6'7". And as you see, he'll be guarded by Billy Thompson, and Thompson stands about 6'9". And Louisville, without the seven-footer or anything like that, but just an overall advantage at every position on the floor.
Especially at guards, and we all know the Louisville guards will post up at every opportunity. The two guards for Cincinnati at 6'1 and 6'2". Louisville, of course, with Lancaster and at 6'3 and Milt at 6'5". Cincinnati's last victory was up in Cincinnati, January 6, 1976. Louisville has won the last 15 meetings. Manuel Forrest, that's a nice way to come back for the junior forward out of Moore High School from that injury, the concussion sustained Saturday, is to hit his first shot of the night. And Denny Crum got exactly what he wanted out of the first shot. That is, get the lead on Cincinnati. 10 seconds against the Bearcats because of the pressure. And the ball goes over to the Cardinals.
Violation.
And that's something else that Denny Crum and the Cardinals want, is to keep that pressure on to force the quicker tempo in the game. Cincinnati playing a 1-2-2 zone.
Jumper from the left side. The Cardinals are 2-for-2.
Wagner.
Manuel is 1-for-1, and Milt Wagner is 1-for-1.
Is nice. John Tong sitting next to you?
Yeah, he must be. There's Dale. Drives all the way, and a foul called. Missed the shot. But the infraction whistle against Milt Wagner. It's 4-0 Louisville. Mark Dale, 6'5 freshman out of East St. Louis, will go to the line. He's only shooting 36% from the free throw line. As you take a look at Tony Yates, the Cincinnati coach.
Cincinnati as a team hitting only 53.8% from the foul line.
From the field, there is not a single Bearcat this year who is shooting 50%. Not a single one. Whereas you contrast that against Louisville, Gordon 56%, Wagner 54, Jones 53, Thompson 59, McSwain 72, Hall 59. The only starter less than 50 is Manuel Forrest, 45%. Missed both free throws, and the Louisville Cardinals finally come up with a loose ball. Wagner down to the left side, looks inside for Charles Jones, back to Milt, and his jumper. Nope, missed that one. Comes off the board to Cincinnati. His tempo is a little bit faster than I expected so far in the first 2 minutes of the game. We expected Cincinnati to take their time setting up the offense. They seem to really be into the flow right here.
They are looking for the shot.
It's not helping much.
It's got to go in. They're only hitting less than 40% on the season. They only shot 29% against Louisville in the first game. And you just don't win many games when you can't shoot the ball in the basket. That's been one of the big problems all year.
Turnover against Billy Thompson. Tried to pass it inside, and it was stolen. Doris back out front to Wilson.
Dave, I asked Denny Crum if Louisville might do anything special to try and up the tempo a little bit.
Quick hands by Lancaster Gordon to create that steal. Takes it all the way down. Spin move. Dropped it off to Billy Thompson in the lane. Tried to put it up. It was tipped away. Almost rolled out of bounds and finally picked up by Gordon. And then taken away from him by Mark Doris.
Crum's answer was the standard Louisville style of play is to force the tempo a little bit. And even if they tried a few special things, it wouldn't really help them in the long run. They wouldn't do anything gimmicky. They'll just try and pressure Cincinnati and keep the game at an upbeat tempo.
It is 4-0 right now. Louisville's lead. Chapansky looking inside. He's got to get some help. He's got to get rid of the ball. Finally does to Wilson. There isn't very much movement at all right now inside for Cincinnati. Wilson looking down low, turn around, jumper. The left hand, it's no good. And a quick whistle underneath, and it's against Louisville. It's against Manuel Forrest.
And there you get a bit of an idea of why Cincinnati's shooting percentage is not that good. Mark Dale shooting it up at a height disadvantage, had to force it a little bit. And you're just under constant pressure. You can't get any good shots that you'd like to hit.
When you have the height differential, you have to change the normal projection. You have to adjust. Outlet pass goes to Wagner. Picks it up, gets it to Lancaster. Looking inside for Charles Jones. His first shot of the night off the glass is good. 6-0 Louisville has jumped out in front of Cincinnati. If you could write a script, if Denny Crum could have written a script back in the locker room and said, okay, now what I want to do is score the first 6 points of this game, you couldn't follow the script any better. McMillan lost control of the dribble, brings it back out front. Manuel Forrest, Milt Wagner, and Charles Jones have scored the only basket so far in this game. Wagner goes for the steal, will have a jump ball, and this time the possession belongs to Cincinnati because Louisville controlled the opening tip. Bearcats still looking for their first connection from the floor tonight. They've already missed also two free throws. And Tiggs, who had been a starting guard, 5'7 freshman out of Russellville, Alabama, comes into the contest for Cincinnati. Tony Yates very quickly goes to the bench. We're barely over 3 minutes into this game.
Tiggs even smaller, only 5'7", but apparently they want his ball handling in there because Louisville was getting a few steals.
Cincinnati going inside for Doris, tipped away by Phil Wagner, I believe. Lancaster has it. Across the key, pulls up, 15-footer. Nope. Emmanuel Forrest, big rebound. Strong rebound. Missed it, tipped up. Nope. Missed out. And Dale comes out of there with it for Cincinnati. One time in this series, Cincinnati led the series 18-15. That was in 1976. 18-15. Cardinals won the next 15. They take a commanding 30-18 advantage in this series. And so far, it looks like they're going to add to that tonight. There's a timeout here in Freedom Hall. 16-03 to go in the first half. It's the Cardinals 6. The Bearcats, nothing.
Generation dancing all across the nation. Oh, what a time, what a perfect time. It's gonna be Pepsi now.
Oh, what a time, it's gonna be Pepsi now.
What a time for living.
It's gonna be Pepsi now.
The winning taste is Pepsi.
It's gonna be Pepsi now.
It's Bluegrass Lincoln Mercury's $300 below invoice sale. Buy a brand new 1984 Renault Alliance or Renault Encore at $300 below invoice and get 11.9% financing too. Buy a new Alliance or Encore at $300 below invoice.
Bluegrass has it.
Positively has it. Bluegrass has it.
Bluegrass Lincoln Mercury, 4301 Shelbyville Road.
This game has not begun the way we expected it to based on what happened up in Riverfront Coliseum a week and a half ago. We expected Cincinnati to take the air out of the ball a little bit, and so far they're playing with Louisville but not playing very well.
Well, they really haven't had much of a chance. You see 0% and several turnovers. We just got the sheet. They have committed three turnovers already. Yes, Louisville too. But Cincinnati really hasn't had much of a chance to really set up a real deliberate attack because Louisville steals the ball from them.
They've only had three opportunities to score. They missed those. And they also missed two free throws. So they've shot actually five times, and they're blank so far. Louisville has shot seven times from the floor. They made three, and that's why we stand right now at 6-0, Cardinals. Charles Jones missed that one. Louisville's really getting the opportunities, Paul. Doris, he's their leading scorer. They're only scoring double figures, I think. And the best shooter they have, percentage. I think he's hitting 48%. They have some players, like a starter is shooting about 29%. Marty Campbell was a starter. He's shooting 28%. Tiggs to Mark Dale. He's picked up by Wagner. It is 6-0 Louisville. We're almost 5 minutes into this game. And now we're starting to see, I think, a little bit of the tempo that we expected out of the Bearcats tonight. Very deliberate. Foul called. Milt Wagner reaching in. They're going to call that every time on you, Milt.
exactly what I heard Denny said. Front him. Because they'll whistle you if you reach from behind like that. Most of the time, they're going to whistle. Takes good move by Takes. His shot, but it is no good. Cincinnati, 0-4. Tipped away by Dale and out of bounds. It belongs to Louisville. Bearcats are 0-4 so far in the game from the field. Andy Forrest needs some help in the backcourt. He's going to bring it up himself. Into the front court. Almost lost control of it. Stansky had touched the ball. Tony Yates arguing that it should have been a double dribble. Jones inside. Debbie Thompson, his first shot of the night. No good. Cincinnati's moving the other way. Still looking for that very elusive first score of the game. We've gone almost 6 minutes. Tiggs. To McCollum. Or Wilson, rather. And he's going to put it up from long range. Dale had it, lost it. Put back up. Nope, missed that one. Tipped up and rolls in.
I think Doris got it.
Mark Doris.
I think even the Louisville fans cheered that one a little bit.
I think Cincinnati is about 1 out of 8 now. It is their first score. Now, when you can go, this is the problem right now for Louisville. And of course, from outside. He hits. And he has 2 for 2 in the game. But this is the problem for Louisville. You made the other team miss every shot they've taken for 6 minutes so far in this game, and you're only up 6-0. Right now, it's 8-2. You would think that if the other team hadn't scored in 6 minutes, you'd be up by about 18. Mark Doris hits again. 8-4. Louisville's lead.
Doris plays center, listed at center, doesn't really play a true center, is more of a forward, and actually I think Louisville recruited him as a big guard, so that's how out of position he's had to play on this small team.
Cardinals have not gone to the bench yet. Still operating with the first five. And we've played over 7 minutes here in the first half. It is 8-4, Cardinals. Good defense that time. Outstanding defense. Thompson tried to score. Lancaster had it, missed it. Thompson gets it back, and 3 seconds called. Well, the ball just went out of bounds off of Louisville play. Long pass. Intercepted by Charles Jones. Went past Japanski. Thompson lost it. Picked up by Bill Wagner off the glass. Yes. What you might call scoring ugly, but it still counts.
Louisville like to get a lot of transition baskets like that, because when you set up your offense in this kind of game, you fall a little bit into the Cincinnati pattern of things, and then you know you're not going to get as many shots, and then you think, well, it's important I make this shot, and everything snowballs, and you begin to tighten up, and you just can't get into the good rhythm. So what Louisville would like to do is get some turnovers, get some transition baskets, and be able to score on the quick pace like that.
Heckman has come in for Cincinnati, and Jeff Hall has entered the game for the Cardinals. 6'4 sophomore out of Fairview. Dale blocked by Thompson. Foul call, Thompson. Well, Cincinnati, when they break that press, Paul, they are just taking it hard and fast to the hoop. And making Louisville commit. It's a nice pass, and Dale takes it up strong, but Billy Thompson goes up there with him. Gets the ball and also part of the arm.
Actually, that still looked like a pretty clean block on the replay.
You want to call the ref over and have a look at it? Mark Dale's at the line for Cincinnati, shooting 2. He's been playing much better lately, averaging 6 points a game and 6 rebounds for the season. But over the last 5 games or so, he's been averaging 8 rebounds. So he's been rebounding better than Mark Doris, who's been playing in the middle. That's no good, and Thompson has it. It's 10-5. Louisville's lead. He goes down hard. Got submarine.
Boy, and Charles, I think it looked like he hit his head. He's going to get up. I thought he might be knocked out. He initially went down on his hip, and then I thought his head banged into the floor. That was really scary looking, but apparently Charles is okay.
Well, that one did hurt. Let's take another look at this one. He was submarine. His legs were knocked out from under him, but it wasn't on purpose.
But watch his head. I thought his head came down and hit hard on the floor. Well, he'd like to have had it ended that way, yeah, as it did on the replay where he never touched the ground.
John shooting two here.
Charles has a little bit of toughness in him, wouldn't you say?
Yeah, I'd say so.
I think the floor would crack before he did.
Charles makes both of his free throws to put his Cardinals up by 7 at 12-5. Louisville needs to take advantage of every break they can possibly get tonight. Almost a steal there. Doris, turnaround jumper. Yes.
Boy, he has a nice touch.
Yes, he does. You can tell he's a player.
He has 6 of their 7 points.
He's a senior out of Cincinnati. I think he played at Hughes High School up in Cincinnati. Knocked away from Wagner. Still belongs to the Cardinals. And there's a timeout. 11:52 remaining in the first half. And the Louisville Cardinals, looking for their 16th consecutive win over Cincinnati, are in pretty good shape right now. It's 12-7 Cardinals. We'll be right back.
When you put all you've got in what you do, then what you make becomes a part of you. You give it your best, and you keep in mind it's something you'll be proud of for a long, long time. And American Builders is working to say, Louisville's growing the American way. It's good work, but it's hard work, and sometimes it takes a toll on you. But we're building for the future, and we won't stop until our pride comes shining through. We give it our best, so we can say, Louisville's growing the American way.
I'm a little bit surprised by this score, Paul, because I don't think we've had a slowdown game at all or a deliberate game being played by Cincinnati. We're almost midway through the first half, and it's still only 12-7.
I think Cincinnati has played some. I think they've played a little slow. I think Louisville has probably forced it a little bit to their liking, more so anyway. Neither team shooting real well, and both teams turning the ball over a bit more than they like to. Less than a sellout crowd. The weather may have scared a few people off, although the roads are really pretty clear. I can see empty seats in the end zones, but another good crowd in the 15,000 neighborhood tonight.
There might be a capacity crowd on Sunday, don't you think?
Just
Super Bowl
might.
Sunday here in Freedom Hall when Louisville hosts UCLA.
You know the only time Louisville has beaten UCLA?
Championship.
That's right.
Jeff Hall. That's his first shot of the night. Missed it. Charles Jones picks it back up. Tries to get it to Billy Thompson. And it was tipped away. Tiggs with it for the Bearcats. Down low on the left side. Back to Tiggs. And you know they're going to look for Mr. Doris. As Paul mentioned just a moment ago, he has scored 6 of their 7 so far in the game. Keckman looking inside. Tipped away. Finally recovered by Dale. Bearcats still with it. And Tiggs will set it up. Tony Yates, coach of Cincinnati, apparently made a pretty good move, Paul, when he put Tiggs in to set up that offense. He wasn't getting the kind of play that he wanted. Jumper, no good by Tiggs. Thompson pulls it down. Outlet to Jeff Hall, but it was tipped away by Tiggs, and Manuel has it. It is 12-7 Cardinals. Wagner. Oh,
nice
pass. Oh, yeah. Mill went up to take the shot and saw that Charles Jones was wide open underneath.
Louisville should really be able to beat Cincinnati inside just like that, too, with the good jumping ability and the size advantage.
Well, it was good penetration that time. That's what created the opportunity by Wagner, and then he drew 3 Bearcats to him, and Charles was wide open. 14-7. Cardinals, again, have doubled the score on the Bearcats. Tiggs trying to go to Doris, and Manuel Forrest is all over. We're almost midway through the first half and the 10-minute mark here.
Louisville really fronting inside. There's just no way that Cincinnati is going to get an easy pass in the post because Louisville defense front on their front line.
Doris is hot tonight. Doris has 8 out of the 9 Cincinnati points. It is 14-9, Louisville. Thompson drops it off to his former high school teammate at Camden. Kept away that time from Thompson, picked up again by Miller. There's this very deliberate style that Charles Jones to Jeff Hall, and Charles was fouled. I think Keckman got it.
I think Louisville, Dave, is to be commended. They've shown pretty good discipline in their offense when they have not been able to get the transition basket. They've run the panels pretty well. They don't really like to do it that much, but you just have no choice in this kind of game.
You lose the momentum. You lose tempo. You're just not smooth and fluid. Maybe it's a loss of concentration. It's a deliberate style of game that you're being forced to play tonight. You want to pick up the tempo with great defense. That's where you'll pick it up.
Manuel Forrest is a perfect example of how big a part of the game confidence is. He's playing so well right now because he thinks he's going to play well.
Steal by Louisville. Wagner out front to Billy Thompson. Walk with it. And Mark McSwain, the freshman, 6'7 from Atlanta, comes into the game for Charles Jones. He gets a breather. Lancaster Gordon also back up off the bench to come in. And sitting down will be Milt Wagner. It is 16-9. Louisville's lead by 7 right now over Cincinnati. Remember what happened up in New York. Another steal by Louisville. Billy Thompson. Missed that shot, tipped up by, was it Manuel? Yep. He wound up on the floor. Let's see what the call
was. He made the first try, and then Thompson got fouled. But that's twice on the press that Louisville has gotten the steal by forcing Cincinnati to throw the ball over, and then they've overthrown, and Louisville has picked off the long pass.
Thompson will go to the line for a couple of free throws for Louisville. Hansky and Wilson back into the game for Cincinnati. Remember the game that Milt had up in New York against Iona after he sustained the injury just above his forehead. The cut came back and played so very well. And Manuel, I think, is 3 for 3 tonight following the concussion. And these guys play hurt, don't they?
Just got to bang them around a little. Louisville's 4 for 4 at the foul line tonight. That's their biggest lead of the game.
Double the score again on the Bearcats. Wilson, being double-teamed, brings it back out front to Tiggs. 8.5 minutes to go in the first half. Lancaster went for the steal from Doris, didn't get that. Hustles back on defense, however, helps out against Doris inside. Dale to Shapansky, out front Tiggs. Oh, they're playing very aggressive man-to-man defense. If you can't get into the movement of the ball, the motion of the game on offense, you sure can do it defense. This is where you don't fall asleep. Whistle inside. And the foul against Billy Thompson.
Well, I think Paul. John Bell's offensive foul. Okay.
That's his first and the 14th foul against Cincinnati. Is a timeout. 7:57 to go in the first half, and the Cardinals up by 9 on the Bearcats.
This bud's for everyone who keeps things rolling in the mighty Mississippi.
Breakaway barge, breakaway barge. Please respond.
Let's get them.
Yeah, just for you. That distinctively clean, crisp taste that says Budweiser. For all you do, this
Bud's for you. The merits of keeping all your eggs in one basket depends mainly on the type and the stability of the basket. Keeping your financial dealings with one institution makes sense from the standpoint of convenience. And if that institution happens to be one of the largest and strongest of its kind in America, it makes sense from the standpoint of stability. And when your money's insured, it makes even more sense. Great Financial Federal, for convenience, stability, and safety. Your investments earn dollars and make sense.
It's the Louisville Cardinals against the Cincinnati Bearcats tonight in Freedom Hall. Louisville looking for its 16th consecutive win over Cincinnati and hoping to extend their Metro Conference record winning streak to 18. You see, Denny Crum currently ranks 7th among all-time coaches in NCAA appearances and championships. Look at that record by John Wooden. Anybody ever going to break that?
No. I guess they say, they do say, all records are made to be broken, but that's one that may stand forever.
Sure is a lot of talent around these days in college basketball. Manuel helping to break that Cincinnati pressure in the backcourt tonight a couple of times. Jumper, right side. Oh, feed to man. I think he's
hit two shots tonight that are from as long a range as I've seen him shoot all year, but he's just so sure of himself now.
20-9, Louisville's lead, biggest, 11. I'm not too sure Manuel's missed a shot. He's got four baskets. I think he's 4 for 4.
I don't recall a miss.
Inside, Mark Doris. He's being surrounded. Missed it and a whistle.
I guess that was just a little foul because it sure was a little whistle.
Just a little staccato whistle. And it was against the freshman McSwain. That's his first. It's the fifth against Louisville. Doris, it's the first. That's his first free throw. He converts that. Reba. So far in this game, it's been Louisville against Mark Doris. Doris has 10 of Cincinnati's 11 points. And the turnover against Manuel. Ball goes back to Cincinnati. Coming up on the 7-minute mark of the first half. Look inside defensively, and you see the Cardinals are fronting those people. Thompson trying to get in front of Doris, and he takes it out on the right wing. And McSwain trying to get in front of Dale as the ball swings to the left side. Takes, lost control of it. Wilson comes over to help out. Louisville leading by 9 right now. It is 20-11. 6.5 minutes to go in the first half. Lancaster Gordon on the steal. Saves it. Up to Billy Thompson. Takes it all the way down. Lays it up. Missed it. And an offensive charge against Thompson. Tiggs. If you were 5'7", would you go back to take a charge from a guy who is 6'8 coming down on you like that?
I don't have to. I can watch. But that's probably a pretty good example of the impatience and the eagerness you feel when you get the ball. Billy forced that a little bit, and he forced it because they'd been laying back there on defense, and now they got the ball, and that's, boy, I want to go with it now. And he really didn't have the shot there.
Let's run. And instead, you wind up getting a personal foul. Tiggs penetrates and then has to bring it back out. There's no one to help. Doris has to chase it down. Charles Jones on him. I'll say one thing for Louisville, Paul. I think they've been playing outstanding defense tonight. Doris over Jones. Air ball pulled down by Manuel Forrest. Clears it to Milt Wagner. 5:50 and counting to go in the first half. Swain. Lancaster. Forrest almost walked with him. First shot he's missed tonight. Goes out of bounds, apparently off one of the Cardinals. 15,000 plus disagree with the call. Arms to Cincinnati. Dale. Uh-oh. Bansky missed the shot. And a foul call. And I think this is against Wilson, number 15 for Cincinnati.
Boy, Cincinnati gets a wide open breakaway, and they can't convert on that either. Chapansky. Apparently they're ruling a foul, but it looked to me like he just lost it. Well, yeah, he may have, McSwain may have stumbled into him a little bit. Looked like he lost his balance and might have nudged him just a bit to make him lose control of the ball. That's a second foul on McSwain. Hall back in for Louisville. He was taken out a minute ago, and I was just watching over on the bench. Jerry Jones was talking to him and even diagramming a little about the press offense. Manuel Forrest had that turnover on the dribble a little while ago, and they were on Hall a little bit about being in the right spot to take the ball. So apparently they got him squared away, and Jeff's back in the lineup.
Chapansky at the line, only shooting 50% from there this season. On the foul, there was a late whistle because the man underneath, as he misses the second shooter, the man underneath could not see the foul. So it was the trailing official who called it. That was the reason we had the late whistle. Wagner.
Yes.
Wagner with six here in the first half. It is, again, double the score here. Cardinals 22 to 11. Missed it, and traveling was called.
They didn't call it until the ball was on the rim for the shot. I thought they were going to let that one go, too.
Everybody here in the crowd had already called it.
He stumbles here on the dribble. Now, they still haven't called anything.
And the problem was when he picked it up. When he got up off the floor, foul called. It's against Campbell. Pass goes inside to Lancaster, and that's a very quick whistle. And this will put Louisville at the line, I believe. Nope, that is only the 15th foul against Cincinnati. It is 22 to 11, the Cardinals leading Cincinnati. Louisville looking to this game tonight to break into double digits in victories this season. Right now, the Cardinals are 9-4. McSwain took the pass and just lost it. Wanted to make his move before he had the ball. I'm going to show you how quick I am. Wilson across the top of the key. Doesn't want to shoot it. Doesn't have anybody there to rebound in case he misses. Mark Doris makes his move against the freshman McSwain. Goes baseline and is cut off of the baseline and fouled by McSwain.
That's three on Mark, and Barry Sumter sheds the warm-up. You can see coming off the Louisville bench. And Barry will check in. McSwain was trying to get in position and couldn't quite get squared away. It was a good call.
He beat him with a first step. So Barry Sumter comes into the Louisville lineup. But the only thing you can do when that man beats you like that is say help. There he goes.
Barry Sumter just checked in for Louisville. Denny Crum was a little upset that Barry, in something like 15 minutes playing time against Virginia Tech, had no points and no rebounds. And he felt he should accidentally get something in that amount of time. So I look for Barry to be a little more aggressive tonight.
Mark Doris with the free throws. Anybody else scored? For Cincinnati?
He has 12 of the 13 points.
It is 22 to 13, Louisville. Wagner missed it. Rebounded by Mark Doris. To take 4.5 minutes remaining, first half. Wilson fakes and then puts it up. Didn't get it. Rebounded by Charles Jones, tipped away from him on the floor. Finally scooped up by Barry Sumter.
Tony Wilson had his best game in Cincinnati's last game when he scored 19. Tonight, he's scoreless and has thrown up two shots that were nowhere close to the basket. That's just how some nights things are good and some nights things aren't.
Do they have anything on the stat sheet for picking up a loose ball? That's what Barry did. And it results in a Louisville basket by Jeff Hall. He'll go back and tell Denny that. He says, I got a loose ball tonight.
We'll create a column if we have to for him.
Marty Campbell goes baseline. Barry Sumter can't give it up, Barry. Cannot give up the baseline.
Got a foul.
It's going to cost you. Got a foul too, Coach. Got a loose ball and a foul. It is 24 to 13, Louisville by 11 right now.
Barry was back alone, the last line of defense on the press, and he just let Campbell get by.
Yeah, Campbell just suckered him. He slowed it down like he was going to wait for his teammates to arrive and then kicked it into overdrive. Well, Louisville scores here. I've been saying all night they've doubled the score on Cincinnati. Cardinals score here, they'll do it again. Wagner. Oh. Put up by Barry, and he was pushed from behind. So he'll go, Barry Sumter will go to the line. Foul was on Campbell. Sumter had good position that time. Milt wanted a foul right there. And then Barry tips it up, and you can see he's pushed from behind. There's a timeout here in Freedom Hall with 3:41 remaining in the first half. Louisville in front of Cincinnati, 24-13. We'll be back with more action after these messages.
Bluegrass Hardware Store.
Right now, your Bluegrass store is featuring the all-you-need kit from Formby's. Find out how easy refinishing can be, even for the beginner. Each kit contains furniture refinisher, tongue oil, refinishing pads, and illustrated instructions. Formby's, it's all you need to make old look new again.
Bluegrass Hardware Stores, when you shop best.
You want something new?
Introducing Arby's Real Croissant Breakfast.
Our breakfast is for you.
Light, flaky, buttery croissants.
You like to look for more.
Fresh eggs, crisp bacon, sausage, ham, mushrooms, and cheese.
To you we say au jour. So welcome to Arby's. You're right where you belong.
Arby's Real Croissant Breakfast.
Well, the tempo of this basketball game tonight may have so far been controlled by Cincinnati, but the contest itself has been controlled by the Louisville Cardinals, who scored the first 6 points of this game, and they've led it all the way.
You mentioned at that time that if Denny Crum could have written a script, that would be it for Louisville to get the early lead over Cincinnati, and that they did. The Bearcats are 4 of 13 from the field for 30%, and all four of those field goals by Mark Doris. He has 12 of the 13 Cincinnati points.
Who's the other one that's sticking out like a sore thumb that has the one?
Markdale, 1 for 2 from the foul line. They're 5 of 11 from the foul line. This team just does not shoot very well.
Fantastic. Does he get the roll? No. Didn't get the tip either. Jeff Hall, fade away. Didn't get that one. Pull down by Dale. 24-13, Louisville. Coming up at the 3-minute mark of this first half. Campbell, back to Tails. Dale, Wilson. That is the first Bearcat other than Doris to hit a basket tonight. That was Wilson. Wagner, no, Barry Sumter. Yes, strong rebound, and he's fouled. As he tried to put it back up, Dale got him from behind, I believe. That was on Doris. Doris in the front and Dale in the back. Wagner normally does not miss that. Ball came right to Barry. Got a rebound, two ball.
And now he can get a point. Two.
Did you settle for one? Barry Sumter, 6'11 freshman out of Lovejoy, Illinois. Shooting very well from the free throw line this season, 78%. Makes the second one.
Do you have that? Did you check the right column? I had him hitting something like 8. Well, we just saw it on the screen. 8 of 20 from the foul line. Well,
I don't read things. I may have been reading the wrong. Was that Doris? No, that was Campbell.
Campbell
got that. Well, now we got some other Cincinnati Bearcats who are finally getting into this basketball game. Doris. I think Doris just got tired and finally started talking to him and saying, I need some help, guys. I'll call inside. This will put Louisville at the line.
That's 4 fouls on Campbell by my count.
Yeah, it is. Officially, it is his 4th.
Well, Sumter will go right back to the foul line.
All right, now let me check these statistics here. I got the sheet right here in front of me. Game-by-game totals.
Everything but what you want.
Let me see. 1/2 gallon of milk, 1 dozen eggs. No, that's the wrong sheet. Barry Sumter. Yeah, I don't know what happened. I think I was reading Mark McSwain there because McSwain is 78%.
Well, Barry's now 3 for 4 tonight.
Yeah, McSwain's name on the sheet is just above Barry. I was trying to help Barry out and make him feel better. You know, if you tell the guy he's a good free throw shooter, it'll give him confidence.
I see.
27-17, Louisville. That was Doris. And he's in double figures. He's got, what, 14? Louisville's lead is only 8. And a foul call. Stepanski collects his foul. That's his first, and both teams are in the bonus situation, so Lancaster will go to the line. You see his stutter step moving to the right, fakes right, goes left, and Stepanski tailgates him.
Gordon hasn't scored a point yet tonight, averaging 15.1, second leading scorer for the Cards. I don't recall him shooting more than a couple of times.
Lancaster, number one in steals this season, number two in assists. Second leading scorer with 15 points on the average. Hits them both to put Louisville back up by 10. Bearcats had a little bit of trouble getting the ball in play, but they finally make it. We're coming up on the 2-minute mark remaining in the first half.
You can't move back and forth on the inline like that after a made basket.
Kicked by Sumter. And that's the reason we had the whistle. Ball belongs to Cincinnati, but the fans here appreciate the hustle by Barry.
Barry has come out with a little more fire in his eyes tonight. Gonna play for one.
They're gonna spread it out here.
I'll be darned. 2 minutes to go, and they've just spread it out to the four corners. Well, Denny Crum will let them do that. And it's up to the offense. Joe Ford, one of the officials, just looked over at Hank Nichols and said, should I warn him? And you see Tiggs just going back and forth over that hash mark. That's all he has to do is penetrate that and come back out every 5 seconds.
And Louisville's coming out after him, too. Putting some pressure on, and they throw it away. You put that defensive pressure on, and then the monkey is on their back. And look what happens as a result. Now, if I were Denny, I'd look down at Tony Yates and say, spread it out again for me, will you? Go to the four corners one more time, please.
Ooh, almost had it.
Pass off to Pansky, block. Did Barry get that one? Charles Jones got the rebound, I know that.
Jones blocked it and rebounded it both.
All right, Wagner off the glass. No, three Cardinals tipped it up and couldn't get it. Barry was up there. I think Lancaster was in there, and so was Charles.
Game has picked up in excitement and tempo the most it has all night when Cincinnati went to the slowdown. to slowdown A. The other one was just, I guess, slowdown B.
42 seconds and counting remaining in the first half. Stepanski. Doris. Jumpers, no good. Battle for him. Finally pulled down by Wilson. He puts it back up. His shot's good. With exactly 30 seconds remaining in the first half. Cincinnati cuts that Louisville lead down to 10. Hall into the front court, 22 seconds to go. You think Louisville will settle for the final shot of the first half? Nope. Wagner inside.
Oh, he was raked right down the face and got it in anyway.
He posted up inside, and when he turned around to hit the shot off the glass, he was smacked right in the face. Watch this. He's wide open inside. Dale comes over to help out. Got him right there. Manuel comes back in for Louisville, and Barry Sumter goes out. Let me see. I think Barry did a little bit better, didn't he? Did he get 1 point?
Three out of four of the foul line.
Okay. Wagner makes it a three-point play for him. And it's 34-21. Louisville by 13. I think it's the Cardinals' biggest lead.
It is.
15 seconds and counting remaining in the first half. Japan scheme in the front court. Cardinals will put all kind of pressure out front. Lancaster almost had the steal. Picked up by Tiggs. 5 seconds, 4 seconds, three. Down to the baseline. Got to put it up, guys. 1 second. They won't get the shot off. Great pressure defense played in the final seconds of the first half. And Cincinnati unable to even get the final shot of the half. We're at halftime in Freedom Hall. The Cardinals looking strong against Cincinnati, looking for their 16th consecutive win over the Bearcats. It is Louisville 34, Cincinnati 21. Back with the halftime ceremonies in a minute.
Scored the first 6 points of the basketball game tonight, which is something you like to do when you're playing against a deliberate attack like Cincinnati plays, and Louisville maintained the lead throughout the first half of play. The Cards lead it here at halftime, 34-21. Dave Conrad will be along in just a moment with a halftime interview with a former sports information director at the University of Louisville, now helping out with the coaching duties. First off, to quickly run down the scoring, Louisville with a balanced effort tonight, led by Milt Wagner in this first half with 9 points. Manuel Forrest scored 8, Charles Jones 6, Lancaster Gordon and Billy Thompson 2 to round out the scoring by the starters. And then off the bench, Jeff Hall with 4, Barry Sumter with 3, Mark McSwain did not score in that first half of play. Cincinnati at one time had, I believe it was 14 of its 15 points scored by Mark Doris, or 12 of the 13. At any rate, Mark Doris has 14 points here at halftime out of Cincinnati's total of 21. Tony Wilson scored 4, and Marty Campbell scored 2 points, then just 1 point Dale. Louisville has been in total control of the game, really. They've played alert defense. They have not let Cincinnati get out with any, or Cincinnati maintain that slowdown pace to a drastic extent. Louisville, as we said, got on top early, and the game has been able to go pretty much their way from then on. The Cardinals leading by 13 here at the half over the Bearcats of Cincinnati, who are winless in the Metro. Louisville yet to lose in conference play. Back with more in just a minute.
If your car won't start, maybe your battery needs replacing, or it could be a bad voltage regulator or alternator. It might even be as simple as a loose connection. At G Auto, we won't sell you something you don't need. That's why we're offering a free electrical system analysis. We'll inspect your electrical system for free and show you what needs fixing and what doesn't. At G Auto, we care about more than just your car.
Hi, I'm Tim Kleiza for Green Tree Toyota. As a new dealership, we don't have previous customers. All our customers are new, like us. We realize that for us to make you one of our new customers, we have to provide you with a better price and better service than another dealer. We're determined to do just that to earn your business. Whether it be through the sale of a new car or a small part, you'll find us easy to deal with and appreciative of the opportunity. Try Green Tree Toyota. We're opposite the Green Tree Mall in Clarksville.
Rhodes is having a sale.
Not just a sale, a big sale.
No gimmicks, no hard sell.
No kidding, just quality clothing at tremendous sale prices.
Just what you'd expect from Rhodes.
Watch out, world. I'm going click, click, click. I'm going to get you with the Kodak disc. I'm going to get you with the Kodak disc. As sure as shooting, I'm not going to miss. Not when it's easy as this. I'm going to get you with the Kodak disc.
The Kodak disc camera with its automatic advance and built-in flash is just about the easiest camera in the world to use. No matter who you want to hound, smile.
You can oink, you can moo, you can cock-a-doodle-doo. I'm going to get you with the Kodak disc.
We've got the Comedy Touch with WKRP in Cincinnati.
Shock's been known to work.
Shock? Are you not electrical shock?
No, I mean shock like...
Ha!
KRP, weekdays at 5 on WHAS-TV 11.
We're at halftime here in Freedom Hall, Louisville against Cincinnati, and the Cardinals up by 13 at the half. It is 34-21, and I want to introduce you to Gary Toole, excuse me, who is a volunteer coach, basketball coach at the University of Louisville, and you may recognize the name and or the face as the former sports information director at the University of Louisville. That was years ago. That was in the days of football coach T.W. Alley, followed by Vince Gibson, of course. How long were you SID here at the university?
I was SID 6 years, David. And before that, I wrote for the Courier-Journal. And I left the university in 1978 and went to Cincinnati Bible College as the athletic director and basketball coach there and studied for the ministry.
But as I recall, you were your record as a basketball coach up there was outstanding. How many years did you coach the team up there?
I was there 4 years, and we won 90 and lost 28, and went to the National Christian College Finals 2 years in a row.
So when you were here at the University of Louisville, SIDing wasn't the only thing you did. I mean, you obviously hung around Crum over in Crawford Gym quite a bit to pick up how to be a coach, right?
Well, that comes with the territory. If you hang around long enough, I guess osmosis takes place, and I learned a lot and I enjoyed it, and also learned a lot from Bill Olson, and he helped me a lot with my basketball career, and so I felt like I had good heritage, and and I put it to good use at Cincinnati.
What created the desire for you to change your career from being a sports information director to going into the ministry?
Well, I became a Christian a couple of years before I did that, and I just felt like the Lord really moved me in that direction. I wanted to give him more of my life than what I was at the university, and so it's worked out great for me. I've come back now, and I'm working as a college minister for Southeast Christian Church, and I have an opportunity to work as a volunteer on Denny's staff, and so I've been able to have the best of both worlds.
What you're saying, then, is that you don't intend to use the experience you're gaining now to become a head basketball coach someplace? I noticed a twinkle in the eye when I mentioned that. Is that what your long-range plan might be, or?
I'm really happy where I am right now.
Oh, I love that. So am I, but.
If the opportunity came up and it was the right thing and I felt like that's where the Lord wanted me to go, then I would move in that direction. But I'm not out looking for a job right now. Very comfortable where I am, although I do love to coach.
Okay. What do you pick up when you're hanging around Denny? What specifically do you look for that you haven't already learned?
Just little things, really. Techniques and how he teaches certain things in the offense. You know, we did a lot of the same things at Cincinnati that Denny does here. But the little technique things and the inside things that Denny knows about how to help a player get open inside and little moves that you can make to get yourself open, stepping on another player's foot and pushing off from that and those kind of things that help us. And I've learned a lot about defense, too, from Denny while I've been here.
Don't you miss the days of being a sports information director?
Not at all.
And I know you won't have to think long days.
Not at all. I love the job, and it was fun, but it drains you. And there aren't many guys who stay in the business very long. I felt like 6 years was long enough for me.
I remember a game that we telecast down at Florida State that was carried by a cable outlet, CBN, the Christian Broadcast Network. That we did a game down in Tallahassee with Florida State. We had a feature on at halftime because earlier in the week, Louisville had played here in Freedom Hall, and we went into the locker room at halftime with Denny. When we were then televising the game from Tallahassee, they asked me what we were going to do at halftime, and I said, I have a feature with Denny in the locker room. And they said, what about the language? There's never been a problem with Denny Crum in the locker room as far as language with any of his players. And he tells me he picked it up from John Wooden, his mentor out at UCLA, whose strongest word or phrase was goodness gracious sakes alive. When Wooden said that, Denny says everybody sat up and took notice.
John Wooden's a great Christian, and I know Denny learned almost everything from John Wooden, at least that's what he says. And Denny is a class act, and I love to be around him, and I've never heard Denny swear, and he doesn't use curse words with his players or with officials. And in fact, right now he has a microphone on right now. I don't know who is doing a feature on him, but somebody is, and it's never a problem with Denny. He's very cooperative with the press, and that's one of the great things about being with him.
All right, Gary, thanks for being with us. Good luck no matter what you decide to do, and if the Lord can guarantee you 20 wins a season, I'm sure you go along with that.
Thank you, David.
Gary Toole, the former SID and a volunteer coach here at U of L. Let's check in with Paul Rogers for the first half stats of tonight's basketball game against Cincinnati.
Great cola taste of regular Pepsi Free. And wait till you try delicious Diet Pepsi Free. There's no Diet Cola like it.
We are Pepsi Free. Caffeine free. Taste how good a cola can be. We are Pepsi Free.
Bluegrass Hardware Store.
Right now, your Bluegrass store can show you how to be your own handyman with Skills Versatile Extra Tool. It can be used as a variable speed drill, screwdriver, hammer drill, a power chisel. Skills Versatile Extra Tool, now on sale at all Bluegrass stores.
Bluegrass Hardware Store, when you shop best, you're through shopping.
If you want something new,
introducing Arby's Real Croissant Breakfast.
Our breakfast is for you.
Light, flaky, buttery croissants.
You like to look for more.
Fresh eggs, crisp bacon, sausage, ham, mushrooms, and cheese.
To you we say au jour. So welcome to Arby's. You're right where you belong.
Arby's Real Croissant Breakfast.
$59.99 Nissan.
What?
not a plague. It's the price of Nissan's rugged new 84 pickup.
Right.
It's got a 1,400-pound payload.
More than Chevy S10 or Ford Ranger.
Yeah.
A double-wall cargo bed that's standard.
Toyota's isn't.
Oh, yeah.
And the biggest standard engine in its class.
Yeah.
59, 99, Nissan. For a small truck buyer, it's a great call to make.
Get major truck value at your Kentuckiana Datsun dealer.
4-21, the halftime score. The Louisville Cardinals have the lead over Cincinnati in a game that has gone about as you might have expected. Cincinnati trying to keep the tempo slow, although at times the Bearcats have shown signs of looking for the basket and moving in for the shot a little more so than they have at other times this year. But by and large, it's been a Cincinnati deliberate style, and Louisville trying to speed it up, and Louisville pretty much winning that battle. The Cardinals' worst shooting game of the season was the first game of the year against Kentucky. Their second worst shooting game was when they played Cincinnati a week ago Saturday. They shot 43.5% in that game, and here in the first half tonight, Louisville is not shooting well, 41.4% from the field to Cincinnati's 42-1. So we've talked about how Cincinnati is not a good shooting team, but actually they have outshot Louisville in this first half tonight. There you see the shooting percentages. Louisville with a lot more field goal attempts, 10 more to be exact, 12 of 29 for their 41.5% to Cincinnati's 42%. That's still above Cincinnati's season average and well below Louisville's shooting percentage, which is the best in school's history at this point. If they were to go on and shoot as well as they do for the rest of the year, they're hitting 54% from the field as a team. Louisville shooting very well from the foul line and winning the rebounding battle. Cincinnati does have the game's leading scorer in Mark Doris, who at one time had 12 of the 13 Cincinnati points on the scoreboard. Then Wilson with four, and Campbell and Dale, the only other players to score, and Campbell in foul trouble, having picked up four personal fouls in that first half. Louisville getting a typically balanced scoring effort. Milt Wagner leading the way with 9, and Manuel Forrest with 8. Charles Jones with 6, and Jones also had 5 rebounds. Forrest had 4 rebounds to go with his total. Cincinnati did have 9 turnovers, and 5 of those credited as Louisville steals. So you made reference a couple of times, Dave, to Louisville playing a good defensive game tonight, and I think that points that out.
I think the Louisville Cardinals would be would have to be pleased with the outcome of this first half, especially because since they knew coming in that Cincinnati wanted to control the tempo of the first half. The worst thing you can do is let Cincinnati get ahead, and yet late in the first half when the Bearcats went to the spread offense, the four corners, they turned the ball over and Louisville scored. But if you wanted to write the game plan, it would be right now. Up by 13 at halftime, you score the first 6 points of the game. Everything's under control.
I had mentioned at the beginning of the telecast that I thought if the game were in the low 50s, say a final score in the low 50s or so, that Louisville might be in a bit of trouble. It should be close. That if it got up in the 60s, then you'd probably consider that Louisville had controlled the tempo and be in pretty good shape. Well, you get a 34-21 halftime score. That's right on target for the high 60s, and that puts the Cardinals in pretty good shape.
You see the backcourt scoring, and it's very much lopsided in Louisville's favor, 15-4, the Cardinals over the Bearcats. The Louisville Cardinals back in action here in Freedom Hall Sunday afternoon at noon against UCLA Bruins.
That'll be the third of 5 straight home games for the Cards, who then go out to Southern Mississippi for one. We'll televise that one, and then also we have a couple of games right after that against LaSalle and Philadelphia and Florida State.
Looking forward to Hattiesburg, aren't you?
Yeah, I'd like to go back to that state place we found there after the football game a couple of years ago. I hope the game is better than that football game was a couple of years ago. Louisville will start out the second half with possession, owning that 13-point lead. Cincinnati in a man-to-man defense here to open the second half of play, and Lancaster Gordon has the ball.
I think
for
if the Cardinals would shoot it well against Southern Mississippi, they would score almost as many points as Southern Mississippi's football team did. Don't you?
Charles Jones is fouled, and it'll count. That was 40-0 or something.
It was a long night.
That is the first foul on Derek McMillan, and Charles Jones, who was perfect at the foul line in the first half in 2 tries, will get a chance to convert a 3-point play here. He has just given Louisville their biggest lead of the night. And Jones is 3-for-3 at the line, 37-21. Louisville still in the all-court press. They back it off a little bit. Stolen away, knocked away by Jones. Gordon with it now. Threw a bad pass. Cincinnati will get it back.
It's a good pass by Lancaster, but Milt wasn't looking for it.
Joe Neiman into the game for Cincinnati, a senior from Cincinnati. Averages about 3.5 points per game. Actually, Cincinnati's leading scorer for average is Joe Stiffen, but he is out with an injured knee, although I'm told he is capable of playing, that he's okay, and they may start giving him some playing time again here in the next few games.
Now, speaking of knee problems, Robbie Valentine's in street clothes tonight because of his recurring knee problems for Louisville.
Been bothered by that bursitis that he says just sometimes bothers him and sometimes it doesn't. No real way to know when or why, but he hasn't practiced too much really since the first of the year. Another steal for Louisville. Gordon's one on two, knocked away for nine, but then Neiman can't get to it in time.
It's good hustle by Neiman, because otherwise Lancaster's either going to score or drop it off to Charles Jones, the trailer for the stuff.
He saw him poke it away cleanly from behind, but Louisville keeps possession. Milt Wagner in backcourt. Cincinnati 2-3 zone on the inbounds play. Louisville getting the 1-4 alignment against the zone. Now Thompson breaks up, but the pass goes to Gordon instead. Louisville very patient offensively. They've been this way most of the night at the set end of the floor, and Jones hits. Jones has all 5 points of the second half, and Louisville's lead suddenly balloons to 18, and the Cards get another steal. Gordon. Forrest. 10 points for Manuel Forrest. And Cincinnati calls timeout. Louisville has quickly upped the lead to 20 points at 41-21.
In Olympic bobsledding, our lives depend on our equipment. She's got to hold together under more G-forces than a space shot. The whole team pitches in, because coming down the run, this sled's all we've got.
To everyone who's working hard for America's Olympic efforts, this bud's for you.
The merits of keeping all your eggs in one basket depends mainly on the type and the stability of the basket. Keeping your financial dealings with one institution makes sense from the standpoint of convenience. And if that institution happens to be one of the largest and strongest of its kind in America, it makes sense from the standpoint of stability. And when your money's insured, it makes even more sense. Great Financial Federal, for convenience, stability, and safety. Your investments earn dollars and make sense.
Louisville has come out in the first minute, 50 seconds of the second half, and scored 7 quick points to up their lead to 20 points over the Bearcats after it was 34-21 at halftime. Louisville hitting 3 out of 4 shots from the field. And the Cardinals proving to be very tough to beat in Freedom Hall. You see the record under Denny Crum. Their current winning streak in Freedom Hall is at 19. The record, by the way, is 26.
That was a shirt worn by one of the fans here in Freedom Hall tonight. Good double team.
Stolen by Thompson. Gordon and Thompson together. Billy Thompson lays it in.
Well, I tell you, this defense is just taking this game from Cincinnati.
That was Thompson's first field goal of the night, and they nearly got another steal there.
Foul call, I think, against Charles Jones. I believe Louisville scored the last 12 points of this game, too, Paul. I think at one time it was 31-21.
Cincinnati just turned it over on the inbounds play. Here you see Louisville forcing the ball out of bounds there. Then Cincinnati stepped on the sideline, I think, as they threw it in, and Louisville has it right back. Now Louisville has scored 9 straight to open the second half. I don't recall exactly what it was there in the first half, but
they had scored the last 3 points of the first half.
So they have scored 12 in a row. Calvin Pfeiffer checks in for his first action of the night. Another freshman. He's from East St. Louis, Illinois. Averages 3.5 points per game. Louisville up by 22 points. Milt Wagner connects. And Milt now with 11 in the game. Charles Jones took it away when Wilson tried to dish off the pass. No good from Wagner, but he was fouled.
Boy, that's an unselfish play by Lancaster. I mean, Gordon could have taken that shot himself. And Milt was just hooking around underneath and drops it off.
Milt Wagner, a Camden, New Jersey junior, shoots 82% of the foul line, has 11 points tonight. He's the Louisville Cardinals' leading scorer this season at 17.6 per game. Milt is also the leading assist man for Louisville. It's funny, you don't really think of Milt that much as a passing guard. You think more of Thompson, his good passing, and maybe Charles Jones a little bit, but Wagner is the leading assist man.
He's also the best free throw shooter they have, with the exception of Jeff Hall. I think Hall's shooting 88 and Milt's 83%.
Loose ball.
I think it was a foul against Lancaster.
Pfeiffer had, it was on him. He's come in and picked up two quick fouls. 46-21. There you see the foul as they scramble for the loose ball. Kind of tough to call one there, but they did. Louisville's outscored Cincinnati 12-0 to open the second half. We haven't even played 3 minutes yet. Neiman dropped it out of bounds when Gordon tried to feed it inside. Louisville retained possession from under its own basket. Hank Nichols, the official, handing the ball to Thompson. Forrest gets another one. Manuel Forrest has 12 points, 48-21.
17 straight points.
Here's Pfeiffer way out, working on Forrest. Now Gordon picks him up. Keckman bounces down to Campbell. Little contact out on the floor, and a foul is going to go against Milt Wagner of Louisville. Milt's third. That's the first on Louisville this half. Rather quiet crowd. Very quiet crowd. This is Keckman with the ball for Cincinnati. They're just saving up for Sunday. Who makes a noise when UCLA is in here? Turnaround by Campbell, no good. Cincinnati still scoreless. It took them 6 minutes in the first half before they scored. Gordon took a hard fall, and then Thompson fell over him. Gordon is hurt. And so is Thompson. They're both staying down.
I thought there should have been a foul right here. Lancaster went down hard. I think they're both okay, though.
And then Thompson fouled him when he stepped on him, right? Yep. Marty Campbell takes it all the way. Will not go. And another foul. Well, Cincinnati with a chance to score for the first time in the second half. Marty Campbell, who has 2 points in the game, missed one previous free throw try tonight.
That is an imperfect 2-for-2.
.48-22, Cincinnati's first point of the second half. It took them almost, well, a little over 4 minutes to get it. Jones missed it in close. Throws it back up and is hammered to the floor.
Oh, my.
That brings an appreciative round of applause from the crowd and a smile to Charles's face.
Now, Charles went up strong there with the left hand. Miss that one, tipped it up again, still battling for it.
And then Pfeiffer came down strong.
It just knocked him over.
Pfeiffer's picked up three fouls since coming in here just a few minutes ago. Jones is 3 of 4 now from the foul line with that miss. Louisville hit 10 of 11 in the first half. Charles Jones from Scuba, Mississippi, now with 12 points. 49-22. This is Pfeiffer reversing toward the middle. Neiman missed from out front, and Gordon has it out for Louisville. 3-on-3. Wagner pulls up. Tipped in by Charles Jones.
Charles Jones, the Metro Conference Player of the Week for his performance against Virginia Tech. I tell you, sometimes he can take over the boards by himself.
He definitely did against Virginia Tech the other day.
Down the stretch.
Came down to get the ball time, and Charles got it.
He was Superman in that game, wasn't he?
Calvin Pfeiffer out front for Cincinnati. Working on a still slow tempo by the Bearcats. He goes hard to the floor. The ball goes in. Will the basket count or not? It's going to be an offensive charge.
Is that Manuel who stepped in to take the charge there? I think so, from the forward spot.
Yep, there you see him planted right in the middle. Forrest draws the foul on Pfeiffer, who picks up his fourth foul already. He did get the basket, so it's 51-24. That's the first field goal by Cincinnati in the second half. Campbell came down over the back of Thompson. Oh, they called him for traveling. Denny Krebs across the way is just smiling in disbelief.
I don't believe that. You and I both called that one.
51-24, Louisville has the lead over the Bearcats of Cincinnati. Louisville going for its 10th win of the year, third of the Metro without a loss. By the way, Sunday's UCLA game is a designated conference game for Louisville. Blocked by Wagner, but out of bounds. The Cards never could fit South Carolina in on the schedule. So the game here against UCLA and the game at DePaul later are designated conference games. Guess who designated those? The opposing coaches.
It's really nice of them to pick a couple of patsies, right? DePaul is what, second?
Yep.
Nationally? UCLA in the top 10?
They're ranked ninth. Alan Pfeiffer works on Manuel Forrest out on the floor. 5 second count is on, but he penetrated the hash mark. Gives it away to Neiman.
You don't think Dana had a vote in that, do you?
He probably had about four. Oh, they called Gordon for the foul. Now that they blew the whistle, right at the same instant he blocked the shot, like he saw him coming. He said, there's no way he's going to do this without committing a foul. But it looked like a clean block. Watch him swat the ball away.
Well, there was body contact, and that's what he called.
That's the first foul on Gordon. Marty Campbell at the free throw line to shoot two for Cincinnati. Campbell now has 4 points, which is right on his average. He's from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, a junior. To 26. 25-point lead now for Louisville.
I'm not too sure, Paul, that Cincinnati has scored from the field in the second half.
They have one field goal in the second half. Pfeiffer got that one and charged on the play. Jones hooked it inside to Forrest, and then Manuel drew a foul inside.
I think Campbell was hanging on to him.
Marty Campbell has just fouled out with 13:35 to go.
Manuel Forrest got that position right in the key, as you saw there, and Campbell had no choice but to foul him. Doris is coming back in for the Bearcats.
Doris had 14 first half points to lead all scorers. Louisville will inbound. Also into the game comes Merrick McMillan. So Wilson's going to leave. Tony Wilson has just 4 points. Wilson came to Cincinnati on a track scholarship, walked on the basketball team and got a scholarship this year. Just walked over to the bench. 51-26, Cardinals with the lead. Milt Wagner against a 2-3 Cincinnati zone defense, floats it in to Thompson, kicks it back outside, and Forrest misses the jumper this time. Jones nearly jumped up for the rebound. McMillan takes it down for Cincinnati, reverses back outside. Over to Neiman. Oh, got it over the outstretched arms of Charles Jones. Neiman's first field goal. 51-28. Louisville scored the first 12 points of the second half to go from a 13-point lead to a 5-point advantage. And if there were any doubt at halftime, there seems to be none now.
This is a difficult game in which to execute from a Louisville point of view. Charles Jones, nice pass here. The alley-oop goes into Billy Thompson, and then he's fouled from behind.
That foul, by the way, was on Joe Neiman, and so Thompson will shoot 2 free throws. Billy is 2 for 2 from the line.
I would be surprised if Denny were not pleased with his team's effort tonight, especially defensively.
I think it would have to be. Louisville has done what it needed to do to keep the upper hand from the very beginning, starting when they scored the first 6 points of the game. 52-28 Cardinals. Pfeiffer saw an opening for a moment, then to kick it off to Dale. Oh, what a shot. He's fouled.
Yeah, that's a super move by Dale. Because he had Charles Jones on the right side of the basket, and there was no way that he was going to put it up on that side.
That's the fourth foul on Milt Wagner, and so Jeff Hall will check in to replace Milt.
That's the best.
Hall scored 4 points in the first half.
That's the best move we've seen tonight, Paul.
Watch this. Nice pass off after the penetration by Pfeiffer, and Dale scooped it in.
The foul was on Wagner. That's his fourth.
Mark Dale with 3 points in the game. And a chance here at a three-point play. Way off the mark. But Doris has the rebound, and Jones was on his back.
Well, that particular play is reminiscent of what happened Saturday against Virginia Tech. Hokies missed so many free throws, and then they would get the rebound. He has to foul again.
Doris
hope they missed again.
So Doris go right around Charles and get the inside position on the free throw, and then got the rebound and was fouled. This is Derek McMillan on the dribble. Forrest went for the steal but couldn't get it away from Pfeiffer. Now Gordon picks up Pfeiffer. 22-point lead for Louisville. 12 and a half minutes left in the game. Good pass by Pfeiffer. Neiman broke open inside.
Boy, that was a heads-up play by Pfeiffer.
52-32. Louisville's 27-point lead at one time is now 20. Jones wide open. Missed the dunk but fouled by Dale.
Dale wanted a piece of that one, and instead he just got a piece of Charles Jones. Charles goes up very quick. It is rare when he will miss that shot.
2 free throws for Charles Jones. Jones has 14 points tonight, leading scorer for Louisville.
I think Lancaster was on the line. It's going to go back.
I'm sorry. I meant Cincinnati. McMillan off to Dale. Louisville's still pretty aggressive defensively. Foul line jumper. Oh, might have been offensive interference. They let it go, and Louisville comes out with it. Then Thompson has it poked away out of bounds. Louisville's ball.
I think it was a foul, too.
There's a timeout called, and there was a foul. We'll be right back with Louisville in command of this one. The Cardinals leading it by 21 points.
You're the Pepsi generation, dancing all across the nation. Oh, what a time, what a perfect time. It's gonna be Pepsi now. Oh,
something new.
Introducing Arby's Real Croissant Breakfast.
Our breakfast is for you.
Light, flaky, buttery croissants.
You like to look for more.
Fresh eggs, crisp bacon, sausage, ham, mushrooms, and cheese.
To you we say au jour. So welcome to Arby's. You're right where you belong.
Arby's Real Croissant Breakfast.
Louisville has the 21-point lead. They were up by 13 at the half, scored the first 12 points of the second half, and Cincinnati has already lost two players to fouls. Calvin Pfeiffer fouled out just a moment ago. He was the victim of that foul right before we took the break. Louisville has Milt Wagner with four, and Mark McSwain picked up three fouls in the first half, but foul troubles aren't going to decide this game. Louisville's overall ability decided this game, I think, long ago.
Neither is shooting percentage going to decide this game.
Louisville, well, both teams shooting a lot better in the second half.
Over 50%.
Cincinnati.
Cincinnati is shooting 57%. The problem is they've only had seven shots.
Billy Thompson will shoot one plus one for Louisville.
And Louisville's had 13 shots here in the second half. You shoot 100%, but if you only take four shots, you know, go for four for four, and the other team shoots 10%, you know, they hit 10 out of 90, they're going to beat your brains out.
Thompson is 4 of 5 at the foul line tonight, but has only 6 points. Yeah, you got it. 55-32, Louisville. Mark Dale down in the corner to Neiman. Bounces back low to Dale. Double team, shoots anyway, and he was fouled. Jones was there on him.
I'd say the only thing consistent, Paul, in this game tonight has been the Louisville defense. It's been difficult to get a handle on a game like this. It's not that fluid or that smooth. But Louisville's defense has been outstanding because the defense has won the game tonight.
Jones and Thompson, you saw both on Dale, and the foul was on Billy Thompson. That is his fourth. And Mark Dale at the free throw line to shoot two. Dale, a 36% free throw shooter. Watch this one and you'll see why. Just not real good form on the shot. .11:41 left in the game, 55-32 Louisville. Dale looked pretty good on that one. He has 4 points. Gordon goes around Dale, gets it inside. Jones got wide open.
That was a nice pass by Lancaster. He faked it back out to Thompson.
Yeah,
and
I thought it was coming
inside.
Out to Billy. And
so did the defender.
They sagged outside and left Charles Jones wide open under the basket. 57-33, Louisville. This is Doris.
He's been strangely silent in the second half. He spent some time on the bench, of course.
That's his first points of the second half. 16 for the game. And we get an offensive charge on Gordon. He looks at the bench, and Coach Jones and Crum both nodded in acknowledgement. You threw the elbow. Second foul on Lancaster Gordon. Louisville leading by 22 points. Tiggs. Bank shot good by Chapansky. His first field goal of the night, which puts him over his average of 1.9 points per game. This is just Chapansky's third start. Turn around. Whoa, boy, Billy Thompson missed that one badly.
I think it was too easy.
Looked like the ball almost exploded out of his hand when it took off. Good by Doris. Also, Mark Doris picking up, and Cincinnati within 18 now. Louisville got it out to 27 when they had that good run to start the second half. We've played almost half of the second half. Manuel Forrest behind the double screen has a lot of confidence in his shot, and Manuel has 14 points tonight. Stolen away by
by Gordon. Just reached in and got the pass away from Dorsey and then knocked it away from him. Tiggs has it. Gordon's holding his arm like Tiggs put the hatchet to him. Dale hits. Pass up to Jeff Hall. He's open behind the Charles Jones screen, but missed it. Over the backboard, out of bounds to the Bearcats. Milt Wagner with four fouls, and Barry Sumter will re-enter the Louisville lineup. Number 59-41 Louisville. Chapansky back to Doris. And now it'll be Derek McMillan to walk it up the floor. Now Tiggs. Jeff Hall giving him a little room outside. Good fake by Tiggs. Missed the shot. Oh, they called Wagner for his fifth foul. He went over the back of Chapansky. Looked like he reached in and got it, but it'll be all for Milt Wagner, the third player to foul out in tonight's game. Let's watch it. You see Chapansky blocking out Wagner, who goes over his back. Milt fouls out of the game with 12 points and gets a good hand from the crowd.
And this is the earliest that we have seen Kent Jones this season with 9 minutes to go in the basketball game. Kent has seen limited action. He's the 6'2 junior, Charles' younger brother from Scuba, Mississippi. He's only attempted two shots this season, made one of those. He has not been to the free throw line. So you see very limited action. Yeah, and you, Paul, have had the occasion every once in a while to take in the world of practice. I tell you, sometimes Kent Jones at practice looks like a world beater. He is tough.
He really does. You tend to think of Kent, unfortunately, I think, as well, Charles's younger brother who came to Louisville and can't play, but he can play. It's just that there's some tremendous guards on this team. Hook pass from Thompson, but traveling. He traveled. Oh. 59-43, Louisville's lead is 16, so Cincinnati really chopping into it here with 8:52 left in the game.
I think when he first got the pass, he thought it was going to be wide open to the basket. Cincinnati reacted very quickly and had two defenders over there.
Good fake by Doris. Jones blocked it. Sumter retrieves it. Give you an idea of the intimidation factor, if you want to call it that. Thompson into Jones. Sumter misses.
Foul. I think it's against Doris.
Louisville this season has blocked 80 shots. Their opponent's only 33. Cincinnati has blocked a total all season long of 9 shots.
1-1, guys.
Charles has more than that himself.
Yeah, he's got, I don't have the sheet in front of me, but it's about 20, I think. Misses the free throw. That foul was on Doris, by the way.
You're going to send me back to the sheet, huh? Okay.
Not the grocery list, the other one. Offensive foul. It'll come back for the Cardinals. Thompson is the leading shot blocker. I know that.
Now, you say Cincinnati has 9?
Yep. Jones has blocked 26.
26.
Thompson, 20. 20. I'm sorry. Thompson. Jones has more blocked shots. Thompson averages 3 per game. He missed a couple of games with that back injury.
That's two Louisville Cardinals that have more by themselves than Cincinnati put together.
1+1 for Barry Sumter, who hit 3 out of 4 in the first half of the foul line. A freshman from Lovejoy, Illinois, St. Louis area. Thompson inbounds the Hall, deep for the shot on the inbounds play. No good. Boy, did Jones go up to the ceiling to grab that one and put it in.
Have you noticed that he's using his left hand much more this year?
He does use it a lot. He's amphibious.
Yes.
Jones nearly got that rebound. Tiggs circles back out with it. Doris, a long
time. Do you remember the original store, Cincinnati Steel?
Stepped on the inline. Dale stepped out of bounds. Louisville's ball back.
61-45 Cards, and we'll have another timeout called with 7 minutes and 41 seconds remaining. Louisville going for a 3-0 Metro record with a win tonight.
Bluegrass Hardware Store.
Right now, your Bluegrass store can show you how to cut it yourself with a Skill Saw circular saw. Its ball-bearing construction assures smooth operation and a long service life. The Skill Saw circular saw, now on sale at all Bluegrass stores.
Bluegrass Hardware Store. When you shop best, you're through shopping.
Every business day, Monday through Friday, the people at Great Financial Federal are here, working hard to serve you. But after hours, when they're gone, your money continues to work here, earning a high rate of interest. Your money is safe here, too, insured to $100,000 with the Federal Savings and Loan Insurance Corporation. And so for safe, secure, and hardworking savings plans, come to Great Financial Federal. We're making it great for you, 24 hours a day.
70 on hand tonight to see the Louisville Cardinals on their way to their 16th consecutive win over the Cincinnati Bearcats. Right now, they're up by 16. I think the play just a few moments ago when Cincinnati made the steal.
They stole the inbounds play, but then when it came across to Mark Dale, he stepped on the end line when he chased down the ball right there. Oops. Looked like he might have kept his heel off it. Cincinnati still over 50%, 9 of 16 this half. Louisville 10 of 21. Louisville out-rebounding the Bearcats 13-8. Inbounds to Jeff Hall in backcourt. Sumter out high on the floor over to Kent Jones into Thompson. Billy fakes and scores. Only the second field goal for Thompson. A steal by Billy off to Jeff Hall, and he hits. 6 points for Hall, and just blink, and the lead is back up to 20. Started to say about Thompson, he has 9 points in the game.
It's a good pass by Billy. I think he's also one of the top assist guys on the team.
He is, especially lately. Doris hits another one. His passing has maybe been the key thing in Louisville's winning streak, which is about to hit six. 65-47. Good touch by Barry Sumter, his first field goal. And Barry has 5 points, 67-47.
I'd say he's improved his performance from the Virginia Tech game about 1,000%, right?
A little better for Sumter. 20-point lead for Louisville. The Cards have the ball. Thompson waving his offensive alignment. Drops it inbound. Stolen away, though. McMillan blocked by Thompson, but it'll be a goaltend. First 2 points for Derek McMillan. Was it or wasn't it? I don't know. 67-49. Knocked away from behind by McMillan, but a foul on Derek McMillan, his second. Jeff Hall, the best free throw shooter on the Louisville team, will go to the line. Jeff hitting 88% from the free throw line. The Ashland sophomore has 6 points tonight, averages 11 a game. Stays at 18. Doris and Thompson, a lot of bumping inside. Now Doris out to the left, over to McNally, who's in. Fakes, missed. Thompson lost it, but then McKechnie couldn't get to it in time. Louisville's ball. Mike McNally is a sophomore from Cleveland, Ohio. He is number 20, who entered the game a moment ago for Cincinnati. Forrest out of bounds for Louisville into Kent Jones, double teamed, and he's fouled.
McNally got him, so we'll go to the other end and shoot. I expect to see a lot of reserves get in here pretty soon. Who we got left? Danny Mitchell. Of course, Robbie Valentine, as we mentioned, is in street clothes. You've got Chris West and Bill Olleges, who are being redshirted. That's what I'm counting who's left.
Jetter. Jets over there.
Stolen away by Forrest and then taken away from him, and he gets it back. Somebody take this thing. 5.5 minutes left in the game. Oh, nice touch pass from Thompson over to Sumter. Billy just more deflected that than passed it over to Sumter. Beautiful assist. Doris will go to the foul line after missing the jumper.
Doris is the only Bearcat who's given the Cardinals any problems tonight at all.
Well, he has 22 points in the game.
Almost half of his team's total. Boy, that was a nice pass by him. Looked like he was playing pinball machine himself, right?
Mark Doris has had a good game tonight, but it's not very often that one man will beat you. 69-50, Louisville with the lead. A bit more than 5 minutes left. Manuel Forrest, hook shot by Emmanuel, won't go in. With the game pretty much out of hand, I think Tony Yates has given the Bearcats a little more of a free hand.
Especially that guy.
And I think they played better this way. Of course, Louisville probably has kind of let it go, too, without challenging him a lot.
I let that guy play on my team anytime, Doris.
McMillan fouls Hall. Luther Tiggs will check back in for Cincinnati, replacing McMillan. That's the third foul on McMillan. Hall missed his earlier free throw try. 1-1 coming up here. Danny Mitchell steps off the Louisville bench, heads to the scorer's table to check in. That's 7 points tonight for Hall.
Manuel Forrest going out.
Manuel leaves the game with 14 points. Jeff's 1-for-3 tonight. 70-52. 4.5 minutes remaining in the game. Hall bumped Tiggs, but no call. Good move to the basket. Good strong move by Mike McNally. 70-54. Louisville led by 13 at the half. Quickly went ahead by 27. Scored the first 12 points of the second half. Then it's kind of settled in at about a 16-18 point game for a while as Barry Sumter gets point number 9.
Well, I tell you, the Cardinals have really gotten some production out of Barry tonight.
Mark McSwain will re-enter the game also for Louisville at the next break. Doris gives it off. Back out to Tiggs. Long one. Sumter chases it down. Good pass to Hall. Will he dunk it?
Yeah.
Oh!
Whoop-de-doo! Down Hall.
Bring out the scorecards.
You got to give him something for degree of difficulty, you know it.
Danny Mitchell can't handle the pass.
Boy, I save that one for the archives.
The reverse dunk by Jeff Hall just made it a 20-point lead for Louisville with 3:19 to go.
Here it comes.
This Bud's for everyone who takes the power and sends it down the line.
This Bud's for you. For all you do, the king of beers is coming true.
Yeah, just for you.
that distinctively clean, crisp taste that says Budweiser.
For all you do, this Bud's for you.
If you want something new,
introducing Arby's Real Croissant Breakfast.
Our breakfast is for you.
Light, flaky, buttery croissants.
You like to look for more.
Fresh eggs, crisp bacon, sausage, ham, mushrooms, and cheese.
To you we say au jour. So welcome to Arby's. You're right where you belong.
Arby's Real Croissant Breakfast.
Well, we're certainly not surprised with Louisville's lead of 20 points with 3:19 remaining in this basketball game, but I'd say with nearly 16,000 on hand tonight, if you have to be surprised with one thing, it would be this reverse dunk by Jeff Hall, that's for sure.
Remember when Daryl Dawkins made Chocolate Thunder famous, Roger Berkman got a couple of breakaway dunks and coined himself Vanilla Thunder. I think we'll have to get Jeff Hall a name tag of some kind. Cincinnati down by 20, and the Bearcats lost it out of bounds, or are they going to keep it? Yeah, they'll keep it.
I was going to point out that I think almost the 16,000 on hand would be surprised tonight, Paul, that already Cincinnati has scored more points than they allowed Louisville in that slowdown at Cincinnati.
Great block by Sumter, but Diggs is there to track it down. Good, out of left corner by Keckman.
I mean, he blocked that so clean, I don't think it had left the guy's hand.
74 to 56, Louisville with the lead. Sumter down on the baseline, has to kick it back out. Louisville still showing a lot of discipline running the offensive patterns here with the game out of hand in the late stages. Nobody getting too reckless. Lob in, knocked away, and they'll get Neiman for the foul.
Posting up inside, that's McSwain, and then Neiman has no choice but to foul him. Once he gets control of the ball that inside like that, Mark's only a freshman, but he is strong.
From Atlanta, Georgia, Mark McSwain is still scoreless tonight.
He'd have been shooting
that's
well,
not
too.
77% free throw shooting there. 74-56, Louisville leading it in the final minutes of the game. 2:15 left now. Dale spins, has it knocked away. Dale got it in by, I think, McSwain. They're going to get for the foul. Made a good fake underneath. Mark Dale has really come alive here in the second half with 8 points, or with 7 points and a half.
They hit Kent Jones with a foul. You had your choice among three Cardinals,
yeah,
down
and
there.
Yeah, Sumter were there, and McSwain from behind then came over, but they did get Charles Jones for it. Dale misses. Louisville's ball with a 16-point advantage. Bad pass. has 10 points tonight. Luther Tiggs walks it over the midcourt line. Loosely guarded by Jeff Hall. Now over to Doris, back to Tiggs. Doris inside on Sumter, so Tiggs shoots from outside. His first basket. 76-62. McSwain lost it, but got to it in time. Lowell about to get caught for a 10-second violation. They do. It's been a little sloppy here the last few minutes. Less than a minute remaining, as you see. Cincinnati will go down to its fifth straight loss and 14th in 16 games. Neiman gets the inbounds pass to McNally, then Jones deflects a pass, but Keckman chases it down over to Tiggs. A 16-point advantage. Bad pass. McSwain threw it in, and it was a bit behind Kent Jones, who couldn't quite reach it. Cincinnati's ball. Mark Dale will take it out of bounds. Tony Yates has been rather calm through most of the game tonight. It's got to be difficult for Tony. He knows what it was once like at Cincinnati, and he's really taking his lumps here in his first year.
Well, they had some great basketball teams and tremendous success under Ed Drucker up there in the early 60s.
Long one good by McNally. He's hit two from long distance, 74-60.
Make this thing respectable.
Minute and a half remaining in the game. Good fake by Sumter over Dale, but he missed the shot, but he was fouled. Dale bumped him on the elbow.
You notice what the other Cardinals are doing, and I don't know whether it's a conscious thing or not, Paul, but they're really looking for Barry. It's like they are very much aware of Charles Jones being a senior, and Barry needs to get that ball as many times as he can to get that experience for next year because he's going to be playing in the middle. And I don't know if it's conscious or not, but they're really working for him.
I would say it probably is. Denny Crum is always making a point of doing things in game situations. You're not going to learn sitting on the bench, and they want Sumter to be more aggressive. He has 10 points tonight. Luther Tiggs walks it over the midcourt line. Loosely guarded by Jeff Hall. Now over to Doris, back to Tiggs. Doris inside on Sumter, so Tiggs shoots from outside. His first basket. 76-62. McSwain lost it, but got to it in time. Lowell about to get caught for a 10-second violation. They do. It's been a little sloppy here the last few minutes. Less than a minute remaining, as you see. Cincinnati will go down to its fifth straight loss and 14th in 16 games. Neiman gets the inbounds pass to McNally, then Jones deflects a pass, but Keckman chases it down over to Tiggs. I believe believe Sumter got a hand on that one. Jones retrieved it. The outlet to Hall with McSwain. Couldn't get it. Get it, Danny. Danny Mitchell gets in the scorebook. 78-62, less than half minute to go. Long one by Tiggs. Sumter has a barrel of rebounds, but then throws a bad pass. And Keckman gets the lay-in. 5 seconds is all. Kent Jones to Mitchell. Got it away in time. Doesn't go. Final score. The Cardinals never in doubt in this one tonight. They win it by 14, 78-64. Back.
The Denny Crum Show with University of Louisville head basketball coach Denny Crum and Action 11 sportscaster Dave Conrad. Today's show is being sponsored by Budweiser, the king of beers, and proud sponsor of the U.S. Olympic team. For all you do, this Bud's for you. By Great Financial Federal, making it great for you. By Arby's Roast Beef Restaurants in Louisville. Welcome to Arby's. You're right where you belong. By Bluegrass Hardware Stores. When you shop Bluegrass, you're through shopping. And by Pepsi Cola General Bottlers Louisville, Kentucky. Bottlers of Pepsi Cola, Diet Pepsi, Pepsi Free, Pepsi Light, and Mountain Dew.
Hello again. Welcome to the Denny Crum Show. Coach, could you imagine 6 weeks, 8 weeks ago, after what happened in the opening game of the season against Kentucky, that after 14 games, you'd be 10-4?
Well, not with the schedule we play. I try never to predict won and loss records, because then if it doesn't work out like you wanted it to, it's very frustrating. So what I do is I try to set a goal to get better each week. And then at the end of the year, the one loss usually takes care of itself. But we don't really talk about winning too much. We just talk about playing hard and trying to get better, and usually it takes care of itself.
And after the opening game of the season against Kentucky, it had to get better.
Well, right. It'd been hard to get any worse than that. So I guess from our standpoint, we know that we're getting better. We know we've still got a long ways to go, and if we can just get a little more total concentration on basketball, at the right times, I think this team could get better real quick.
Are you getting the consistency or close to that you need, especially out of the forwards, Billy and Manuel?
No, and that's still our main problem. They'll play real well one game and not the next. What we need is to get all five or seven or eight players playing up to their ability at the same time with the total concentration it takes to play well. And it doesn't take much to distract you in these days. There's so many things outside that can distract you. And if you're letting anything bother you, if you're thinking about anything else, you're not going to play consistently well. It's like shooting free throws. If you're thinking about the one you just missed, probably you'll miss another one. If you can block that out of your mind and concentrate on the one you're about to shoot, you have a lot better chance to make it. And I feel that way about our team. We've got to get a lot more total concentration about basketball for a total of 40 minutes every game if we're going to be good enough to be competitive at the end of the year.
The first thing we're going to take a look at is one of the most exciting games ever played in Freedom Hall, and that was last Saturday's win over Virginia Tech. It was a miracle.
Well, sometimes you have to expect those. Oral Roberts does.
And they always seem to come through for him, and they came through for the Louisville Cardinals on Saturday. Let's take a look at the highlights. It's the Hokies in town, and they are were one of the favorites going into the Metro Conference season. And it was an outstanding basketball game, and they are quick, Coach.
Yes, they're very quick. They play well, and we had to play well to beat them. I felt coming into the game that we'd have to get real good play out of Billy and Manuel to have a good chance to win. As it turned out, Manuel played super early in the year, and then he got hurt. There we throw an alley-oop pass to Milton, and Billy throws it in the basket. It counts 2 points either way. But Manuel played really well early. Shot the ball fairly well. He worked hard. He got open. He did a lot of things. There's the controversial goaltending call. Did the ball come out or didn't it? And it's hard to tell from the camera angle. But Charles was a tower of strength for us in this game. And I thought that his overall play was the determining factor. Billy gets in foul trouble early. Manuel gets injured, and he goes to the hospital, so we're not in a position to to get the play out of our forwards that we really need. And we had a great game out of Milt. Manuel played well till he got hurt. Here's the play, fouled right there. He gets slapped, gets away, and there's the contact. Now, who's the contact on? That's a free ball. It could have gone either way. They called a foul on Manuel, which added insult to injury because he got a concussion out of it, too. So it was just one of those things, but he's fine now. But Milt shot the ball well, and we played really hard. I didn't think we got near as good a play out of our bench until Jeff played well at the end that we needed to get, and consequently struggled, I think, a lot more than we probably should have, but the bench did not play good until the end. And then Jeff Hall came through and hit a couple shots for us. But that shows their quickness, and that's Del Curry, their great guard, and he really is a fine basketball player. And there's Jeff on the miss. I guess it did go in.
Yeah, he got the roll on that. That's touch.
That's a good bounce there. There's Milt from the outside. There's Milt again. And when he stops and is in balance like that, boy, he shoots the ball well. And here we are down 69-61. We were down 69-60. There's Milt on a little dipsy-do move, which is okay when they work. And there's Lancaster. And we put a lot of pressure on him down the stretch at the end. And we needed it because we were way behind late in the game with less than five to go. And Jeff had not played real well up to this point, and then he hits a couple in the one there that was the tying basket. And there's Charles Jones, who just doesn't quit. He got it back in the basket for us. And there's Jeff on the other one that he hit. And then he hits a couple key free throws. And Milt hits a jumper where he makes a good stop and is in balance. There we make a lazy pass. As it turns out, it didn't beat us, but that kind of play can. You have to snap the ball and be, you know, quick and alert. They stole the ball from us, I think, something like 17 times or something in a game, which has to be a record. Making 17 turnovers is not unusual, but to have them steal passes 17 times is way too many. I don't know, sometimes they're just quick and they anticipated well, but we were just a little careless, I think.
And Charles Jones, for his effort in that particular game, was named the Metro Conference Player of the Week. He just had a super game.
Well, he only had 4 points and four rebounds at halftime, but the second half, he ended up with 13 rebounds, gave him a career high, I believe, 17 rebounds, and against a real good basketball team. Mm-hmm. So it was very pleasing. We wouldn't have won without him doing all the things he did for us in that second half.
I've seen, you mentioned something about Jeff Hall. He did not play well for most of the game that he was in, but down the stretch, when he needed to come through, he did. Now, he's done that several times this year. I can recall in one particular game where he had the ball swiped twice, right back-to-back. Was it Iona?
It's happened to him a number of times. It happened to him in this game.
And then he comes right back and hits a big
shot. He's a tough, hard-nosed kid, and he doesn't quit. I mean, anybody can make mistakes, and that's how you learn, but he doesn't quit. He just hangs in there, and then when he gets his opportunities, he takes advantage of them, and he is a great shooter, and he shoots it well under pressure. He just sticks it in there, and I have confidence in him. I want him to shoot when he's open. He'll hit the ball. He'll hit it most of the time.
It was a big win for the Louisville Cardinals over Virginia Tech, and then on Wednesday night, Cincinnati's Bearcats came to town. Highlights of that contest coming up. Stay with us. Wednesday night in Freedom Hall, Cincinnati's Bearcats came in to play Louisville, and I know that you were nervous about that game.
Well, you always are, because a team like that gets ahead of you and spreads you out and makes you play defense 30 of the 40 minutes of the game. It throws your tempo off, and I felt coming in that I wasn't going to try to do anything to get our players excited and jazzed up. I just wanted them to have a little pride in what they were doing and get out there and play hard. In the first half, we played fairly hard, but we made a lot of silly mistakes and really didn't do things as well as we should have. And then in the second half, we had a little talk at halftime about some things, and they came out in the first 8 or 9 minutes of the second half. We played about as well as we have all season until we got 28, 29 points ahead. And then they relaxed a little bit, and we substituted very freely. That was the big difference between the game at Cincinnati and the game here in Louisville. We never did get very far ahead of them, and we never could relax, and we never could get the subs in the game and let them play some. And in this game at home, we did all of those things, and so it was much more gratifying. But the key was getting ahead early and making them play.
Well, I mentioned on the telecast of the game in the first half that if you could have written a script back in the locker room before the game, you would say, I'd like to score the first 6 points of the game.
Naturally, against a team that wants to hold the ball on you, that's your best out. You get ahead and you make them, then they have to play.
And that's exactly the way it worked out for you. But you didn't take advantage of their mistakes.
No, we didn't. We didn't capitalize a lot of times when we should have, because we turn around and make some silly ones of our own, or we didn't shoot the ball real well. We shot the ball better from outside, but I don't think we shot it very well from inside.
Could have been ahead 14-0, 16-0, but then you made some silly mistakes early. Let's take a look at the highlights. Wednesday night, Louisville against Cincinnati, and we'll check out the Cardinals scoring their 16th consecutive win over the Bearcats.
It's been a long time since they've beaten us, and as soon as you say that, they'll turn around and beat you, so you don't like to say things like that. But we have played well. We got the first two baskets there against two different types of defense, and then we get the ball inside to Charles, and he hits a good shot. So we're up 6-0, and that's what you've got to do against a team like this. The further you are ahead, and there's Manuel, and he shot the ball well. That's what we tried to do. We tried to get up in front of them, make them throw over us, which makes them run, even if they score and beat us. There, Billy was trying to do something, and he fumbled the ball. Fortunately for him, Milt was there to pick it up. But here we get it in. Milt made the penetration, kicked it off to Charles, and there Manuel hits another jump shot. And his shooting has come along, as his whole game has, as he's gotten a little stronger and a little better physically. And there's one of the few times we've thrown across when the team sags defensively against us, and there's Milt from outside. Manuel shot the ball real well. But I thought our whole team played hard. I don't think we played a real good game early, but I thought after halftime was over that we really got after them. I know we opened up a 12, 13-point lead to somewhere around 29 points before we really kind of let up. And I think that's as good a stretch as we've played for 8 or 9 minutes, and it really pleases you to see them play that well, that hard. Sometimes you play hard and you don't get a lot of things done, but we played hard, and we played real well through that one stretch. We didn't make many mistakes. We capitalized on our shots. And then after that, when we got ahead quite a ways, then we were able to play a lot of the other players and get the subs in there and give them a chance. Charles Jones had a great game, had 19 points and 9 rebounds, and played real well. Billy played real well the second half. Yeah, Lancaster's been hurt with a shoulder problem. He's got a little bursitis in his shoulder. He's having trouble getting his arms up above his shoulder, so he's had a lot of trouble shooting the ball, but hopefully he'll be a lot better by tomorrow. Yeah, but that we had good ball handling, and we assisted well. We got the ball to the open man. Charles, it was nice to see Charles shoot the ball. And Barry came in, had 8 rebounds, and hit 5 out of 7 free throws, I think, which is a season high for him. And he also shot the ball well from the floor. Good ball handling and passing. We got the ball to the open man, and that's what you need Barry to do. Of course, he's playing against 6'6 guys instead of 7-footers, so that makes some difference, but I think he's capable of doing that. And there he is again on a quick steal, and he gets the ball down to Jeff, who puts a little Daryl on him and does a little reverse dunk. And of course, that pass was a little off, and Mark couldn't handle it, or he tried to handle it one-handed, one or the other, and Danny Mitchell gets a basket, which was pleasing. But Coach Yates is a real fine guy, and he's worked hard, and he's got some good young players. He just needs a little time to get that program going. They've been down the last few years, but I think they'll come back. I think he does a real good job.
Based on what the Louisville Cardinals did early in the second half against Cincinnati, you must have had a nice discussion at halftime.
Well, I didn't do any yelling or screaming or anything. I just talked to them about some things we had to learn to do, and we had to be more consistent, and we had to play a little harder, and some sweet things like that. And they responded very well. They don't always respond when you talk to them. or a coach would talk to them for every game, and they would respond, you know, if it was automatic, it would be a cinch. But the psychology involved, you don't want to get them all fired up and jazzed up to play tonight because or on Wednesday, because you know that if you just play a decent game, you should win this one. And then you save the psych up part for the UCLA game. They're the team that you're going to play on national TV. It's a designated conference game. They're ranked in the top 10. That's who you want them to really play against, and you want them to do that for 40 minutes. It's hard to do that twice a week. It's hard to do it once a week where you get everybody doing it. So I didn't get on them and push them that hard, but we did play well for that first 9 minutes of the second half.
Late in the game when you had Barry in, and he came up with some good figures for you, an outstanding production night against Cincinnati. Is there a conscious effort for the other players to go to him thinking about next year or thinking about getting
him
into the offense?
I don't think it's thinking about next year. I think what it is that he's big and imposing in there, and they know that if we're going to have a real good team down the stretch, that we've got to get some production out of he or Mark. I mean, we can't have nothing coming off the bench. When you substitute, you've got to either get better or hold your own. And some games we haven't done that with them. And when he comes in and plays like that, we've got a lot better chance.
This is the Denny Crum Show. The Bird's Eye View is coming up. We'll meet some of the assistant coaches of the University of Louisville, and we'll still talk about UCLA, which is tomorrow in Freedom Hall. Be right back. When we look at college basketball today, names like Knight, Smith, Valvano, and Crum dominate the headlines. While this recognition is natural, some people seem to forget about the great assistant coaches involved in these programs. At U of L, fans have a high regard for names like Jones, Houston, and Dotson. Denny Crum told us a little bit about his assistants.
You need people around you that can do the things that you don't have time to do. You have to have a variety of different talents in your assistant coaches. They're all totally invaluable. There's no way you could get along without them. I feel very fortunate that they've stayed with me as long as they have.
Jerry Jones comes to us from Pepperdine University. Along with his work on the Cardinals staff, Jones also heads up U of L's nationally regarded basketball camp.
As far as basketball goes, with helping Coach Crum with the basketball coaching and helping make arrangements for the trips and all the little things he doesn't want to do, I get to do.
I asked Coach Jones if there was a lot of input in decision making.
Well, that's one of the good things about working for Coach Crum is if you've got an opinion, you know, you can state it. And I've learned a long time ago, though, it's easy to have suggestions when you're not the one that's got to make the decisions. But if any of us have an idea that we think will work, we'll go in and talk to Coach Crum about it. And a lot of times he'll tell us why it won't work or disagree with us, and we try to convince him, you know, of our viewpoint. But Coach Crum has the ultimate decision in all the things that we do.
Wade Houston and Bobby Dotson are responsible for recruiting. As Coach Crum told me a little bit about their jobs.
Coach Houston and Coach Dotson have different roles. While they do help at practice when they're here every day, when they're out of town, they're recruiting and making contacts, evaluating talent and players, and they're on the road a whole lot more. And I guess probably their part of the job is important or more important than anything else. Without good players, no one can be, you can be a good coach, but you can't win without good players. It takes a combination of both.
I asked Bobby Dotson just how difficult it is getting to those top athletes.
Say everyone's after the top 20 players, and there's 250-some schools, so that makes it pretty tough.
With all the traveling, recruiting, and coaching going on, it's easy to see just how important an assistant coach's job is. I'm Bob Florio with a Bird's Eye View.
And it's also easy to see why you play a lot of golf in the off-season. You have to get away from all of that pressure.
Well, that's true. I think everyone needs something that's a different type of activity. A number of things I enjoy doing. I like to play golf. I like to hunt and fish. And I like outdoor-type things. I work during the, you know, indoors all mm-hmm. year, and I like to do things outdoors, and I like sports and things that are competitive, and I used to play a lot of tennis, and I almost gave that up for my golf game because I just enjoy being outdoors more. But you do need to get away from it. There isn't any question about that. You're under a lot of pressure for a long period of time. You start in, way back in practice in October, and you go until April. And then you've got the recruiting after that, and then they've changed the recruiting rules now, and they start up again in September again. So you eliminate 6 weeks there that we've had in the past in terms of free time that we could play golf and relax and unwind and get ready for the season. But things have changed a lot over the years. The rules have changed, and so you've got to change with them.
I know that what you look for and what you've been working for with this particular team is that combination, different players together. You're looking for the mesh. You have to have the same thing, I would assume, in a coaching staff.
Yes, if you can't get along with the people you work with, first of all, it's not any fun, and it takes all the pleasure out of it. But secondly, you cannot be near as productive. I think we have a great staff in that we all respect each other. We all have good personal feelings toward each other. We all get along well, and everybody knows what they're supposed to get done, and you don't have to stand there every day and tell them what to do. They know what they're supposed to do, and I expect them to do it, and they know I expect them to do it, so they do it.
And each coach has not necessarily his own area of responsibility, but he certainly has a particular talent that you need in the overall scheme of things, and that's why you put that combination together.
That's right. If you've got one missing piece in the puzzle, it's not complete, and then it's not a success when you view it. And so you've got to have a little bit of everything, and I think we do have.
What's coming up tomorrow at Freedom Hall? The UCLA Bruins. We'll talk about that contest. Stay with us. Be right back. At noon in Freedom Hall, your alma mater comes in to play the Louisville Cardinals. And now you know the players are going to want the Bruins, and you know 16,613 are going to want the Bruins. Play against your alma mater. Does it make any difference that you want them? You want them a little bit more because of that?
Well, I think that's normal. Larry Farmer was a player I recruited to come to UCLA. And so now when you compete against them, you have, you know, some mixed feelings there. UCLA is my alma mater, and I feel very strongly toward them, and I root for them except when they're playing us. But on the other hand, it's still a game that we need to win. It's a conference game for us, even though they're a non-conference opponent because it's designated because we couldn't play South Carolina. So that makes it even doubly important. And the fact that they beat us last year in a game that we gave away makes it, you even want to win even more. So, but between them coming up and then Florida State on Wednesday, we've got two tough conference games that we've got to win. It's important to us if we're going to have a chance down the stretch. You've got to win your home games. It's very difficult to win this conference if you lose your games at home.
You have to play very, very well against UCLA. Are they quick, big, or what?
They're both. Stuart Gray, 7-foot at center. They're 6'8 and 6'7 at the forwards and good guards. They're tough.
We will see you next Saturday with highlights of UCLA, Florida State. Thanks for being with us.
The Denny Crum Show has been sponsored by Budweiser, the king of beers and proud sponsor of the U.S. Olympic team. For all you do, this Bud's for you. By Great Financial Federal, making it great for you. By Arby's Roast Beef Restaurants in Louisville. Welcome to Arby's. You're right where you belong. By Bluegrass Hardware Stores. When you shop Bluegrass, you're through shopping. And by Pepsi Cola General Bottlers Louisville, Kentucky. Bottlers of Pepsi Cola, Diet Pepsi, Pepsi Free, Pepsi Light, and Mountain Dew. The Denny Crum Show with University of Louisville head basketball coach Denny Crum and Action 11 sportscaster Dave Conrad. Today's show is being sponsored by Bud Light. The best has a taste all its own, a clean, distinctive taste you'll find in Bud Light. By Great Financial Federal, making it great for you. By Arby's Roast Beef Restaurants in Louisville. Welcome to Arby's. You're right where you belong. By Bluegrass Hardware Stores. When you shop Bluegrass, you're through shopping. And by Pepsi Cola General Bottlers, Louisville, Kentucky. Bottlers of Pepsi Cola, Diet Pepsi, Pepsi Free, Pepsi Light, and Mountain Dew.
Hello again. Welcome to the Denny Crum Show. This may seem like kind of a movie review program because we're going to talk about the good, the bad, and the ugly. The good was the win over LaSalle. The bad was a loss to Florida State. And the winning ugly was the win over Southern Mississippi.
All right, whatever you say is all right with me, Dave.
It's been a difficult period of time with all of the travel and all the basketball games the Louisville Cardinals have played of late. Let's bring you up to date on the effect of the schedule itself, and then Denny can comment on that. Played Marquette Saturday, left for Hattiesburg Sunday, played Southern Miss down there on Monday, flew back Tuesday, played Tulane Wednesday, flew to Philadelphia Friday, played LaSalle Saturday, flew to Tallahassee Sunday, played Florida State Monday, flew back Tuesday, played Southern Mississippi Wednesday night. Tired.
And the Sunday, Wednesday before the Saturday where you started, we played UCLA and Florida State. So, I mean, we haven't had much rest. We've had very little, if any, practice, or at least days where you can practice hard because you're either coming off a game or got one the next day, and mm-hmm. makes it very difficult to work on things that you need to. And you know they're going to be tired with this type of scheduling, and there's really nothing you can do about it. It's just the way it is. We're playing when you play 28 games during the season, and we had the three in Hawaii that didn't count. They just all add up, and they kind of crunch together somewhere in the season. I was looking at Memphis's schedule, and they play two games in 15 days, so now it's their turn to have a little run, and we'll get slacked off here after another week or so.
What's the obvious thing that you notice, the impact of all of this travel and the scheduling right now?
Just fatigue more than anything else. Not just physical, but mental and physical fatigue. The mind says, let's get it done, and the body won't get it done. I mean, it won't do it. And I think if you have a lot of depth and a lot of players, it's great because you can substitute freely and no one has to play a whole lot, and everybody's real happy because they're getting to play, and, you know, it works out fine. If you're real thin, then it doesn't work so well.
Well, let's take a look at what worked very well, and that was the comeback up in the Palestra last Saturday. It was Louisville against LaSalle. And this was mostly LaSalle early.
Well, I tell you, they were a good basketball team. I know they'd beaten Notre Dame. Traditionally, they throw stuff on the floor when they score their first field goal. But they'd beaten Notre Dame. They beat Villanova. They've played some real good basketball teams and have a very fine team. They've got great outside shooting. That's Black was as good a guard as we've faced all year. I think the only thing that saved us in this game was the fact that they did zone us. It enabled us, I think, to use three guards a lot more than we would, and if your guards are shooting well, that's a real plus. Milt Wagner was in foul trouble in this game, but overall, I thought in this, we played fairly well. And there's the thing that Billy can do for you, though, right there. He has a knack of getting the ball to the open man, and he's worked real hard on that. His shooting has really come around. His defense is improving, and his rebounding's been good. And there he blocks a shot without slapping down, which is good. But he gets the ball to the open man. There's another assist from Billy to Charles. I guess when you get everything going at once, even when you're on the road and everybody's shooting the ball well, things kind of just come together. And this team played us as tough as anyone, and we didn't get any breaks at the officiating. And coming into the crucial time of the game, I thought, we're going to be lucky to pull this one out. And as it turned out, we were. We hit lots of free throws down the stretch, and that was Milt preventing the layup. But we got the ball to the open man pretty well, and we shot the ball well, which sometimes we haven't been able to do, although this has been a good shooting team. That's where Billy's strongest. Boy, you get him in that key area, and he is tough. Of course, Milt shot the ball well. He's been in a little slump since then, and good pass inside. There's a rebound by Billy, and gets it back in the basket. And of course, he does that very well. And there's an assist to Jeff. Billy's tall, got long arms, and he's 6'7". He can throw over that type of press, or that type of half-court zone. There he is again. And he really helps you that way because against zones, they sag so hard and work so hard on the strong side. And they are vulnerable on the weak side if you can get the ball there. And it's a lot harder for a shorter guy to throw the ball over defenders and then get it to him in time to get the shot on the weak side. There's Lancaster getting a real nice rebound basket. Well, he's got that capability of getting up there quick and doing that. We've got into a game here where I didn't think either team was going to stop either one. I mean, we didn't stop them too well, and they didn't stop us. We both scored. It was a relatively high-scoring game. Even though I didn't think we were playing bad defensively, here's good ball handling. Move it aside, get it to the open man, and Billy makes a nice left-handed shot inside. But it was a good game, and you can see what kind of, there's where Billy gets hurt right there. Charles drew the charge, and they both fell right back into Billy. And that's where he hurt some ligaments there. Of course, coming down the stretch, I was very concerned, because without him, we're not quite as good a team in a lot of ways. But we pulled it out. Great block there by Barry. And I think one guy called it goaltending. The out officials, both of them, the play was stopped, I think. But the one official called it goaltending on us, and the underneath official did. The two out officials didn't call it at all. And they thought it was a good block, which it obviously was. The ball just left his hand. And there's the Camden connection up there. And Charles gets a good defensive rebound at a crucial spot. Get the ball. It's a great pass from Milt to Jeff. Crucial basket for us right there, and I think he was fouled on the shot. And nice pass from Charles into Lancaster. It was a great steal. That was a crucial play right there, because they were throwing the alley-oop to Black, and we had a three-point lead, and that would have cut it to one, and then we lose the ball right here. So it was, very important. If they'd scored there, and then we lost the ball, and they come back, scored again, we'd have been behind, and they'd have been holding the ball, and we'd have had to foul them. So that was a great steal by Charles, and there's a foul on Lancaster. There they get it inside, and I think Barry intimidated the man. Lancaster gets the rebound. But that's the kind of aggressive board work you've got to have from your guards, especially when you don't have your full strength up front.
93-88 was the final. It was an exciting game up at LaSalle.
No question about that. We had some question marks about the officiating up there, which we don't need to go into, but there's one guy that we're not going to have anymore. I can tell you that.
Well, then it was down to Tallahassee on Sunday to play Florida State as the Louisville Cardinals looked, I think, for their 23rd consecutive regular season win in the Metro Conference. Highlights or lowlights of that game coming up. Stay with us.
This bud's for everyone who keeps things rolling on the mighty Mississippi.
Breakaway barge, breakaway barge. Please respond.
Let's get him.
This is the night of golden. We're right below here, and we're on our way out.
I'll come around to the port side bumper there.
Yeah, just for you. That distinctively clean, crisp taste that says Budweiser.
For all you do.
There is no other time to plan for the future than in the present. So before tomorrow arrives, make plans to open your individual retirement account at Great Financial Federal. You'll earn a high rate of interest, and there's still time to get tax benefits for 1983. So make your decision today, because if you're like most people, you'll run out of time before you run out of excuses.
If you want something new,
introducing Arby's Real Croissant Breakfast.
Our breakfast is for you.
Light, flaky, buttery croissants.
You like to look for more.
Fresh eggs, crisp bacon, sausage, ham, mushrooms, and cheese.
To you we say bonjour. So welcome to Arby's. You're right where you belong.
Arby's Real Croissant Breakfast.
It says here the temperature on Venus averages 800 degrees.
So let's go to the beach instead.
29 million miles away.
The beach is closer.
Here, finish this off before your ice cubes melt.
Is that what I've been drinking?
Yeah, they improved it.
That's one calorie? Oh, it's got that new sweetener in it.
It's sweeping the planet.
Which planet?
You know, the one with the beach.
Taste improved by Diet Pepsi.
Monday night in Tallahassee, Florida State. Did you
have the feeling ahead of time, or maybe not necessarily that game, but did you know something like a Florida State was going to happen to your basketball team?
Oh, I think it was inevitable, Dave, when you play as many games in a row as we have without practice and without rest and all the travel involved. It's almost inconceivable to play well every night, especially when you're on the road. You know you're going to have some bad nights. And a team like Florida State, I knew they were a lot better than they showed here. We intimidated them early, got ahead of them, and played really well. And we were playing real well at that time. And then I knew they were a lot better team because I saw what they did against all the other teams they were playing. And so I had a feeling that it was going to be a real tough one for us. And then we didn't shoot the ball well, and they played good defense. And, I mean, just it was just a combination. We had a little letdown, which was normal after the emotional comeback victory at the end of the LaSalle game, travel the next day, and then play that night. And Florida State was so fired up. I mean, you got to remember that we beat them pretty handily here, and they wanted their revenge, and they got it. They earned their victory.
And it was a record crowd.
Yes, it was, and they had given away beer for 25 cents, and they were vocal.
Let's check out and see what happened Monday night down in Tallahassee in the Leon County Civic Center, a record crowd for Florida State home basketball.
They played us man-to-man and zone both. They started, they got in the zone, and then there's Manuel making a good block. They started playing us man-to-man pressure, and they did such a good job at it, and we didn't handle it real well. We weren't real sharp, and we didn't shoot the ball well, and I think because of that, they just stayed in there man-to-man, and up here they played us mostly zone. If you're shooting the ball real well, there's Randy Allen, their 6'8 freshman forward, that seemed like the way it went for us right there. We get a shot, and we miss. It comes in, and out. We get a rebound. They block it, come down. Just one of those nights when even though we were trying, we seemed to be a step slow everywhere. We were trying hard, but we just couldn't seem to get it done. And they shot the ball real well and did a lot of things with their pressure that we just didn't handle well. Had we been real fresh, I think we'd have had a lot better chance. They had five or six offensive rebound baskets in the first half against us. And there's Lancaster with one. We played him at forward quite a bit because without Billy, three guards for us is probably our best offensive team. It's not our best rebounding team. It's not our best defensive team, probably, but we have a lot better chance of scoring, I think, in that situation. There's a good steal by Jackson. And they are quick, and they were aggressive, and they just did the job on us. Their Milt should have kept the ball in both hands. Watch the foul come over and hit him on the right arm. If he had his left hand up there to protect and hold that ball, the guy would hit him on the left arm. Nice move. I think that was Randy, too, the freshman. But he didn't have that arm up to protect, and the guy hit the shot. It could have been a three-point play. But they did this to us regular, too. They made good steals, and they got the ball to the right people at the right time. And they really were fired up and played really well against us. We'd have had to play real well, even if Billy was there, to win. We were only down 3 points at halftime, and we're in the game even though we really hadn't played great. But the second half, there he is again, Randy Allen. He's a tough freshman, 6'8", that's got a lot of moves. He jumps real well, he's got great quickness, and he's an excellent rebounder. And there's Martello, I believe it is. He shot the ball real well against us. But their whole team did. Of course, they're about third in the nation in field goal shooting. And so it's not surprising they shot the ball well. And this was early in the second half when we were still into our momentum and playing fairly well and trying to do a real good job. And then all of a sudden, I think we just seemed to run out of gas and everything we did went wrong and they capitalized on it. And nice pass from Jeff into Charles. There he is again. He misses one, gets it back, misses another one, and there's Martello putting it in. And they just seemed to do that to us all afternoon or all evening. Great pass there.
It seemed like the entire afternoon and evening, Coach. It was that long.
It seemed like a long time. When things aren't going well, it seems like it takes a long time. But it wasn't because we weren't trying. We just seemed to be a dollar short and a day late. And that was... We got all the subs in the game now. There's Robbie Valentine, James Jetter.
I think Kent finally
fighting each other. Yeah. Kent got that one in, I believe.
75-60 was the final score. Florida State beats Louisville, I think, for only the second time in the last 15 meetings between the two.
Yeah, and both losses were down there. And
I also think it's the worst regular season conference defeat you've ever suffered at Louisville, either in the Missouri Valley or the Metro.
Well, normally we play well against conference teams, but I think a lot of it had to just built up fatigue and the travel and being at LaSalle. And if it had been an easy game at LaSalle, we might have been all right, but it wasn't. It was a tough game, and we had to fight them all the way and came back from behind to win and without a lot of depth. That takes a lot out of you, and physically as well as emotionally, and we just didn't handle it well down there. But to give Florida State the credit, they earned their victory. They played well.
I think I mentioned in the telecast of the second half of the Louisville-Florida State game, the Cardinals just seemed to be about a half bubble off plum.
They were half off of something, or maybe a full off something.
It was close to full.
Yeah, they just, it wasn't because they weren't trying. They just couldn't get it done.
So we all flew back to Louisville on Tuesday and prepared for another basketball game Wednesday night. Highlights of that one coming up. Stay with us.
Budweiser salutes the coaches and trainers of the 1984 U.S. Olympic team.
Off, I really want you to explode off the line. Arm swing, arm swing.
To the U.S. Olympic coaches and trainers, the team behind the team, this Bud's for you.
Bluegrass Hardware Stores.
Right now, your Bluegrass store is featuring Silicone 2 caulk from GE. Silicone 2 has superior features over standard silicones. It adheres to wood, metal, concrete, and masonry, even most plastics. And it's the only sealant guaranteed for 50 years. Silicone 2 caulk from GE. Available now at all Bluegrass stores.
Bluegrass Hardware Stores. When you shop best, you're through shopping.
The merits of keeping all your eggs in one basket depends mainly on the type and the stability of the basket. Keeping your financial dealings with one institution makes sense from the standpoint of convenience. And if that institution happens to be one of the largest and strongest of its kind in America, it makes sense from the standpoint of stability. And when your money's insured, it makes even more sense. Great Financial Federal, for convenience, stability, and safety. Your investments earn dollars and make sense.
Many transmission shops are here today and gone tomorrow. So if you think you have a transmission problem, then think about this. AMCO has been in business for over 15 years, and AMCO has over 700 shops in the U.S., Canada, and Alaska. Now, that's experience you can trust and count on being here for years to come. So if you think you have a transmission problem now, don't worry about having one later.
Downtown St. Matthew, Shively, Okolona, Elizabethtown, and Frankfort.
Okay. Wednesday night in Freedom Hall, the Louisville Cardinals hosting Southern Mississippi, and that's Barry Sumter. You started him.
Well, we felt we had to try something. Things weren't going real good for us when we tried to start Mark, and not that I'm blaming Mark. We just didn't play as well as I'd hoped, and so we felt, well, we got nothing to lose. Let's try it. And there's Milt Wagner inside against their man-to-man defense.
He went over the 1,000-point career mark with that.
Real nice block there by Emanuel. And he gets the ball, and they fouled us. But that happened to us there too many times. It happened against Florida State, and they're a very quick team and an excellent jumping team. And I thought we were ready to play, as ready as you can be with a half a day in between, if you take away the travel. And I think probably we played fairly well. We didn't shoot the ball well at all. I thought that coming into the game that if we would really have to hustle and play hard defensively, which we did. I thought that was the best defensive effort for 40 minutes that we've had a long time. Nice pass from Milt into Charles. But there's a lot more to the game than defense, although I think down the stretch you're going to win or lose with your defense and your free throw shooting at the end of ball games, and I think that's what we did. We shot the ball 39% for the game and only 36 in the second half. And when you can shoot 36% and still win, nice pass from Jeff into Barry. And I thought Barry did a nice job in there. He had 6 rebounds, played 23 minutes for us. Had 6 rebounds. He had a block shot or two and a steal. You know, just did a good job defensively on the inside. Only got burned a couple times. But he only had one turnover. Didn't make a lot of mistakes. And that's a real plus. There's good rebound basket by Jeff. And we really played hard. I thought defensively it was our best effort for 40 minutes going clear back to Moorhead after we came back from Hawaii, even in the UCLA game. And we played real well. Florida State, we played well. We played great defense for 30 minutes against Tulane and then let up for the last 10. But I really felt for the whole length of the time, as far as the 40-minute game is concerned, that it was our best defensive effort. And I thought we got good shots. Milt was 3 out of 13, and he, I think in this game, let's see, who was it? Trying to remember. Only one player shot 50% for us.
It was Lancaster, wasn't it?
Was Lancaster, yes. He was 6 out of 10. And the rest of them were under 50%, so we obviously, as a team shooting 39%, we didn't shoot the ball real well. And yet, in spite of the fact that we didn't shoot it well, we hung right in there with them and had a slight lead at the coming down the stretch, and they made a few mistakes. We got a couple of steals, and we hit the free throws when we needed them, and I thought overall played well, even though obviously we didn't shoot the ball well. And it's hard to win, especially without Billy, when you don't shoot the ball well. I expected that somebody had told me going in that we only shot 39% in this game, I'd have said, well, the way they're shooting the ball, and they've been shooting it really well, they shot it 60% against Florida State on Saturday, 2 days before we played Florida State. To me, that's an excellent shooting night on the road. And they shot better than 50, I think 52 or better against us. And with us shooting 39, them shooting 52, it means we had to do a lot of things real well. And we did. We only had 10 turnovers in the game. Lancaster had 3 big baskets for us right down the stretch, and Mills hit a bunch of free throws. And we got the ball in the basket real well, which you have to do. Especially in those clutch situations. Lancaster just kind of took this game over, which was good to see a senior do. And we made some mistakes too. Here they get a breakaway layup, but we beat them the same exact 7 points we beat them down there on their floor. Of course, we were on their floor then, and Billy was playing and had a great game for us down there.
63-56, the final. What's coming up for Louisville? We'll talk about that next. Be right back.
Bluegrass Hardware Store.
Right now, your Bluegrass store is featuring Silicone 2 caulk from GE. Silicone 2 has superior features over standard silicones. It adheres to wood, metal, concrete, and masonry, even most plastics. And it's the only sealant guaranteed for 50 years. Silicone 2 caulk from GE. Available now at all Bluegrass stores.
Bluegrass Hardware Stores. When you shop best, you're through shopping.
This bud's to everyone who tackles the changes and challenges of that new promotion.
This bud's for you. There's no one else who does it quite the way you do. So this is you. For all you do,
yep, just for you. That distinctively clean, crisp taste that says Budweiser.
For all you do.
Something new.
Introducing Arby's Real Croissant Breakfast.
Our breakfast is for you.
Light, flaky, buttery croissants.
You like to look for more.
Fresh eggs, crisp bacon, sausage, ham, mushrooms, and cheese.
To you we say au jour. So welcome to Arby's. You're right where you belong.
Arby's Real Croissant Breakfast.
Hey America, your you're gonna love the great cola taste of regular Pepsi Free. And wait till you try delicious Diet Pepsi Free. There's no Diet Cola like it.
We are Pepsi Free. Caffeine Free. Tastes how good a cola can be. We are Pepsi Free.
Couple of Virginias coming at you quickly. This afternoon in Freedom Hall, Virginia. And then tomorrow you'll fly to Blacksburg to play an important Metro Conference game on Monday against Virginia Tech.
Well, neither one of them going to be easy, and even if we were 100% healthy, we'd have problems with these teams. So what can you say? You line up and you play and you do the best you can do. I think it's kind of the end of a long string of every other day games, and I just hope that we're, you know, mentally ready. Physically, it's hard to judge how much it takes out of you, but it'll be apparent when the game starts or before it ends whether or not we're right or not. But I think we're going to want to play bad, and I think we have something to prove against Virginia. Whether or not we're physically capable of doing that or not, it remains to be seen. But it should be an interesting game.
We've talked about the problems created by all of the travel, all of the games you played, the physical problems, the mental problems because of that, mental exhaustion. But what about the absence of Billy Thompson? That has to have an effect, too.
Well, we just have to forget that until he's able to play. There's nothing else we can do. Naturally, it's going to have a negative effect, but we've got to overcome that, put it out of our minds, and move forward.
It takes a little bit of time to adjust to it.
No question about that, but we've got no time. We've got games, so let's get it done.
You shoot it on up,
right? That's right.
Good. And we'll see you next week, and we'll shoot it on up with the Denny Crum Show and highlights of Virginia and Virginia Tech. Thanks for being with us.
The Denny Crum Show has been sponsored by Bud Light. The best has a taste all its own, a clean, distinctive taste you'll find in Bud Light. By Great Financial Federal, making it great for you. By Arby's Roast Beef Restaurants in Louisville. Welcome to Arby's. You're right where you belong. By Bluegrass Hardware Stores. When you shop Bluegrass, you're through shopping. And by Pepsi Cola General Bottlers Louisville, Kentucky. Bottlers of Pepsi Cola, Diet Pepsi, Pepsi Free, Pepsi Light, and Mountain Dew.
I'm really surprised.
Conrad, today's show is being sponsored by Bud Light. The best has a taste all its own, a clean, distinctive taste you'll find in Bud Light. By Great Financial Federal, making it great for you. By Arby's Roast Beef Restaurants in Louisville. Welcome to Arby's. You're right where you belong. By Bluegrass Hardware Stores. When you shop Bluegrass, you're through shopping. And by Pepsi Cola General Bottlers, Louisville, Kentucky. Bottlers of Pepsi Cola, Diet Pepsi, Pepsi Free, Pepsi Light, and Mountain Dew.
Hello again. Welcome to the Denny Crum Show. The season now stands at 16-8. I think we all must be spoiled, Denny, with Louisville basketball of late. Two consecutive Final Four appearances, and I think there's mild depression that has come over Louisville fans of just being 16-8. 16-8 is not that shabby.
Well, it's like anything else. It's what you get used to, and I'm not used to it. I don't like. I'd much rather be 28-8 or something, but I tell you, this team has had its problems, and it had its growing pains early in the year. But with maybe the exception of one game, the Florida State game, and that was after a real emotional comeback victory over LaSalle up there. That particular game, we didn't play very well at all in, and it's not too hard to understand. We lost Billy and they only had a day in between, and we didn't play real well there. But other than that, we've played relatively well. If you counted up the number of games we've lost when Billy's been in the lineup and healthy, it's very few. If you just take that alone, I mean, we could be having a great year in terms of winning and losing. I think this team is playing well right now. If Billy can come bounce back and be healthy, there's no guarantee we're going to beat all the teams we've got to play, because we've got to go to Tulane, of course, Memphis State twice, home and away. We've got DePaul on the road. We've got some tough games coming up, but we can win four or five of those games if we're healthy and playing like we did early in February before he got hurt.
But you're very proud of this basketball team.
Yeah, I've never had a team that had more courage than this team. Well, this team gets down, and it comes right back. I mean, they don't quit. They play hard, and I'm real pleased with them.
Let's take a look at some of the highlights we have for you today on the show. First of all, we have to go back in time. A week ago today in Freedom Hall, in fact, Virginia came to town to try out the Louisville Cardinals.
This is a good basketball team, and we're capable of beating this team. It doesn't mean you're going to beat them every night, but when you play a team this good and you're missing one of your top players, boy, it's hard to play your best game. And they're a good basketball team, and they played well against us, and we made a lot of little mistakes like that. We had four or five turnovers in the first half where we had the ball and just gave it up to somebody that was real alert and quick with their hands. And you know, we didn't do a lot of things real bad. We didn't do a lot of things real well, but we got good shots, and yeah, we just weren't hitting the kind of shots that we normally would hit. This team, we held the 50 points at home. We should have beaten. We only scored 45, and for us against, you know, they're not holding the ball, and we're not holding it either. It's just both teams, I thought, in this particular game played great defense. And what you find in a situation like that is there's another one of our losses. We had that happen to us way too often. And you don't beat good teams turning the ball over on things like that. You capitalize when you get your opportunities, and it's just something we didn't do a real good job of, and we didn't shoot the ball real well. And when you're averaging 76, 77 points a game, and you only score 45, either their defense was great or our offense was atrocious or a combination of both. And they pressured our guards real well, and we didn't have the inside scoring threats that that we would normally have with Billy healthy, and I think that hurt us a lot. But we played hard, and our defense was outstanding, which I think it's been the last few games. We've really concentrated hard and played hard on defense because we really haven't had as many good offensive plays and players healthy that we need. So our defense has had to carry us, and we've really done a pretty good job defensively. We just haven't been able to get the ball in the basket, and we've been in a little bit of a shooting slump, but the effort's been there. We really haven't given up anything to effort. We've really been playing hard, and as you can see, we're right in the game, and we just make a few crucial mistakes at the wrong time. And it's not because we're not trying. Our guys, they're working hard. Their attitude's been good, and they're not depressed and down. They know that they're a better team than our record would indicate. And on a given night, we're capable of beating anyone still. All we need is to have everybody 100% healthy and playing good at the same time. And, we can still end up having a real good year, maybe not in terms of one-loss record. But if this team can win 20 games with the kind of schedule we've played, I think it's an excellent year. And this Virginia team is the kind of team that has excellent ball handlers. They do a great job controlling the ball. And you don't get too many mistakes against a team like this. They're not going to give you any second efforts. They're big and strong and experienced up front, even though they don't have Ralph Sampson anymore. And we really missed the inside play. They did a real good job pressuring our guards, and we didn't get a lot of scoring inside, and Manuel didn't have a real good shooting night. And so we really struggled in playing against them, but I think I'd like to play them again. Who knows, maybe we will. There's going to be a lot of teams qualify for the tournament. And if we're one of them, you never know who we'll get a chance to play. That's Wilson, their little guard. He's really a good basketball player, real strong, steady, heady player, and shoots the ball well, passes the ball well, and does so many things that every time we've played him, Ralph Sampson's got all the credit, and he's been the one that's probably given us more trouble than all the rest of them put together. He's just a real good basketball player. And seems like we can't avoid injuries. It doesn't matter what happens, we're going to get somebody hurt. Poor Charles, nobody knows how much he's been banged around, but he really has been. He's really had some bangs this year, and nothing serious enough to keep him out. But boy, he's really in practice. He's taking some lumps, but it's good. He's a tough kid.
50-45, as you notice, was the final score. Virginia over Louisville out in Freedom Hall. And then on Sunday, it was over to Blacksburg, Virginia for Monday night's Metro Conference encounter against the Hokies of Virginia Tech. The highlights of that coming up. Stay with us.
Bring out your best.
I wasn't drafted till the seventh round. They don't even know my name.
Your best.
Budweiser Live.
Bring out your best.
Budweiser Live.
Bring out your best.
The best.
Kroger, huh?
It has a taste all its own. Enjoy it.
Investing money can be a real adventure. One day you're up, the next day. At Great Financial Federal, our certificates of deposit pay a rate that's fixed for the term of the certificate, with no ups, no downs, safely, securely. So the next time you invest your money, ask yourself this: do you want excitement or do you want results?
Bluegrass Hardware Store.
Right now, your Bluegrass store is featuring the all-you-need kit from Formby's. Find out how easy refinishing can be, even for the beginner. Each kit contains furniture refinisher, tung oil, refinishing pads, and illustrated instructions. Formby's, it's all you need to make old look new again.
Bluegrass Hardware Store. When you shop best, you're through shopping.
If you want something new,
introducing Arby's Real Croissant Breakfast.
Our breakfast is for you.
Light, flaky, buttery croissants.
You like to look for more.
Fresh eggs, crisp bacon, sausage, ham, mushrooms, and cheese.
To you we say au jour. So welcome to Arby's. You're right where you belong.
Arby's Real Croissant Breakfast.
Last Sunday, the Louisville Cardinals flew over to Blacksburg, where really, for the first time, the injured Billy Thompson had a chance to work out. And there was every indication he'd be able to play at that time against Virginia Tech. As it worked out, he even started against the Hokies.
Well, you want to, if a guy's going to play and he's been injured, and he's one that plays normally as a starter, you want to put him in the same situation. And we left it up to Billy. He wasn't 100% well, but he felt that he could play, and we're a lot better team with him in there because he does a lot of things. And I think the fact that he was there and playing, even though he didn't have a great game, it made all the other players better players.
The presence.
Just his presence there and the things that he's able to do, they complement everybody else on the squad, and everybody had more confidence. And it's tough. You play Virginia at home, then you travel on Sunday and have to go to Virginia Tech and not knowing whether or not he's going to play. So he worked out with us slightly on Sunday and said he felt well enough that he would like to try. And so after he warmed up, he said, yeah, I think I'll be all right. So we put him in there, and he played 21 minutes and wasn't spectacular, but just his presence there, I think we played real well in the game. We had a couple of stretches, one in the first half and one in the second half for 2 or 3 minutes each time where we really kind of let down a little bit, but we never quit. And we came back strong at the end and had a real good chance to win, made a couple of mistakes and didn't win, but it wasn't because we weren't trying. It was a gutty an effort as I've ever had a team make on the road.
Let's take a look at it. It was Monday night, Castle Coliseum in Blacksburg, Virginia, Metro Conference game between Louisville and Virginia Tech.
They've got great athletes on this team. They're exceptionally quick, and I thought that if we could play them close or even close to even at their place, that we would be in pretty good shape because I didn't know how well Billy would play or how badly he'd play. There was no way to know that. But just having him out there, I think our whole attitude of our play was good, and that was Billy there. You can see he's wearing number 41. We had a uniform problem, and he had to wear 41 on that particular night. But as you can see, he's not at 100%, but at least he's in the ball game. And Lancaster had an exceptional game, and he's been playing a lot better lately. And I thought
that if we could just play close to this team at Blacksburg, that we'd be on our way back to where we were. And if we can get Billy 100% healthy, well, I think, you know, we can be a real good team before this season's over anyway. But you can see they've got great athletes, Al Young and Perry Young. And, I mean, these guys are, you know, just really good basketball players. They're relatively young still. They'll all be back again next year. And they can shoot the ball, they can rebound the ball, they run really well, they play good hard-nosed defense. That big Beecher there had 5 steals against us in the game. And that's a lot for a center to have against us. Normally, we don't have that problem with defensive centers. And we did a much better job controlling the ball. Curry at Freedom Hall, there's an alley-oop to Billy from Milt. And for a guy on one leg, that's pretty good. And there's Beecher, had 2 or 3 of those on breakaways. He runs real well for a big guy. He's a great shooter. And there's, who was that? That was Colbert, I guess, or Young. But they have real good athletes. And they had this one run where everything seemed to go for them. And then as the game wound down, we started keeping pressure on them. We went to the press, which we didn't do a lot of early because we really weren't, that's Young, their forward. We really weren't, with Billy in there, a real good pressing team. There's another pass from Curry to Beecher. And I felt that if we wanted to keep him in the game as much as we could, that we had to do the things that would help us and not have to use him in that same situation. So we didn't press till we got down the last few minutes of the game. Then we were behind and had to go to the press. And I thought we really worked hard at it, and some good things happened for us. And we ended up in a real good position and had a real good chance to win the game. We had it tied. We never had it tied where we had the ball in our possession, but we did have it tied. And had we been able to stop them or them miss a free throw, we'd have been all right. We ended up right down at the end not making a foul that we needed to make with just a few seconds left on the clock. As you can see now, that there's a play. Well, I'll tell you, if that's a charge, if there ever was, he jumped straight sideways. There we ran a clear out for Milt, and we got the ball into him, and he scored for us. And I think at this point, see, we should have fouled on the end. As soon as the ball came in bounds, we were supposed to foul if we didn't get the steal. And we didn't foul, and ended up fouling right there with 4 seconds to go, and it ran 14 seconds or 11 seconds or something off the clock before we had a chance to foul. You see, I even got my coat off. That's about as hot a gym as I've been in a long time. And I was a little irate that we didn't foul at the time. And Lancaster said he fouled him underneath on the inbounds pass, and there Manuel got the rebound. We had one timeout left, but we didn't take the timeout, and we ended up losing by 2 in a game that we could have won. And in spite of that, Billy only played 21 minutes and was not real effective, but just like I said, his presence in there, I think, made us a better basketball team. And we had a great comeback. We were down 13, 15 points there late in the second half and came back and had a chance to win it. So it was a great effort, even though it goes in the loss column. I was real proud of the effort.
When you have a situation like that, where you can come back and maybe hit the last second shot and force an overtime, and you come up a little bit, you make a couple of critical mistakes at the wrong time. What do you tell the players after a situation like that?
Well, you know, I when I went into the locker room, I was, you know, I was really upset because we didn't do 2 things we had to be able to do to win down the stretch. But when you stop and think about it, we made that great comeback with him setting up Billy on the bench.
Mm-hmm.
And so we did it, you know, with the other players, and that gave, I think, was good for them, gave them a lot more confidence in themselves, and shows them that, you know, they have the ability to do well, and maybe we don't need Billy as much as we think we do. A lot of that can be psychological. So from my standpoint, it was a real positive learning experience, and if we can make that kind of a comeback against a team like Virginia Tech on their floor with Billy on the bench, that's got to give everybody, you know, a real positive feeling about themselves, something that we hadn't had prior to that because we hadn't played real well like that, with one exception, the end of the LaSalle game. We came back and did that. And so, you know, at least we know we're capable of doing that. Now what we've got to do is just get everybody healthy and just play hard as we can, and who knows what'll happen. We're capable of beating these teams on our schedule, even though we could lose them all. But we also might win a few of them.
But it has to be a tough nut to crack from a coaching point of view, because you say, gee, I'm proud of you, because I thought it took tremendous courage to come back from 13 down. But I got to point this out to you, too. I mean,
that's part of the coaching. Sure, yes. You have to do both. You can't just ignore the fact that we didn't do the right things at the right times. You have to make those corrections, make sure they understand why they screwed up in those situations, but then pat them on the back because they made the greatest effort that, I've never had a team make a better effort than that.
Recently out in Freedom Hall, and if you were among the 16,613 on hand, you were all treated to a reunion of the 1980 NCAA championship team. That story on the Bird's Eye View coming up. Stay with us.
It's not just a race. It's a game. If they think I'm tired, maybe they'll make their move.
Bring out your best.
Then I'll make mine.
Bring out your best.
Best has a taste all its own. Enjoy it.
Bluegrass Hardware Store.
Right now, your Bluegrass store is featuring the all-you-need kit from Formby's. Find out how easy refinishing can be, even for the beginner. Each kit contains furniture refinisher, tongue oil, refinishing pads, and illustrated instructions. Formby's, it's all you need to make old look new again.
Bluegrass Hardware Stores, when you shop best, you're through shopping.
We are Pepsi Free. Caffeine free.
Taste how good the cola can be.
We are Pepsi Free. Caffeine free.
And all that taste is caffeine free.
Hey, America, you're gonna love the great cola taste of regular Pepsi Free. And wait till you try delicious Diet Pepsi Free. There's no Diet Cola like it.
We are Pepsi Free. Caffeine free.
Taste how good a cola can be.
We are Pepsi Free.
Boy, Furniture Showrooms has the finest quality furniture at the lowest showroom prices. Right, Cardinal? Just look at this comfortable hide-a-bed. A nice little nest for you or your overnight guests. And this handsome Berkline wall-away recliner. Great for your family room, Cardinal.
You're telling me, Denny? Folks, visit Furniture Showrooms for really fine quality furniture at low showroom prices. Shelbyville Road in Middletown.
Mention U of L basketball to most any fan in Louisville, and if they're like me, they envision that unforgettable experience in 1980 when Louisville won the NCAA basketball championship. Members of that championship team were reunited recently in Freedom Hall.
Right now I'm playing with the San Diego Clippers, so I live there in San Diego, California, during the off season. And during the off season, I decided to come back here and stay.
Do you miss playing college ball?
Yeah, college basketball was such a thrill for me because you got so many people that know the game and game of college basketball. You got a lot of great fans here in Louisville. I mean, you can look up in the stands and look around you and see all the red and black, and it makes you get chills.
Yeah, I felt real excited when I walked in and the game had already been started. You just feel how the crowd just generates everybody and tries to get them, their spirits lifted up, so you just play harder. And in the pros, you really don't get too much of it. The type of crowd is different from that of the college crowd. So when I came back, I said, I wish I was back here just for one more year.
Do you miss playing with the rest of your old teammates?
Well, not really. I like playing against them. The guys that we used to play with in 80, and we get to play against each other. And it's kind of interesting to play against each other, and then you get to go out and we talk about the old days at dinner. It's kind of nice.
Other players at the reunion are now involved in engineering, business, coaching, and in classwork. Now let's look back at the magic of March 1980.
Just one of them.
Reporting for the Bird's Eye View, I'm Mary Kay Fields.
Oh, boy, that does bring back the memories then.
I tell you what, it gives you chills when you think about all the tough games and the overtimes and everything just fell in place, like they say on, what is it, the A-Team? I love it when a plan comes together.
Exactly the way you wanted to diagram it. That's the way it turned out. I was asking you the other day in a conversation we had about the feeling. I mean, it's every coach's dream to win an NCAA championship. And the feeling when it is finally there and it hits you, and you told me it's one of just relief that that you have it.
Well, it's such a tremendous amount of buildup and pressure as the season goes along and you start into the tournament, and each game it just builds a little more and a little more. And when you get to the point where, you know, you finally accomplish it, it's just total relief that it's all over. I mean, you don't really have time to be that happy about it. It's just so much pressure, and it just all kind of comes out of you.
This is the Denny Crum Show, and what is coming up this afternoon down in Memphis, a battle between the Louisville Cardinals and a team undefeated in Metro Conference play, Memphis State. We'll talk about that in a minute.
Early in the year, these guys were down here scouting the kids. Now they're back looking for help.
Bring out your best, Budweiser Light.
Bring out your best,
Budweiser Light.
The best has a taste all its own.
Hey, Bob, you got a minute?
Enjoy it.
Budweiser Light.
Once upon a time, there were three bears, Papa, Mama, and Junior. They were a happy family, but Papa worried about the future. So he went to Great Financial Federal and asked about an individual retirement account. At Great Financial, he found someone who spoke his language, who showed him how he could enjoy tax-free savings and insured safety for his money. Papa opened his individual retirement account at Great Financial Federal and lived happily ever after. Don't you think it bears your consideration?
If you want something new,
introducing Arby's Real Croissant Breakfast.
Our breakfast is for you.
Light, flaky, buttery croissants.
You like to look for more.
Fresh eggs, crisp bacon, sausage, ham, mushrooms, and cheese.
You, we say, au jour. So welcome to Arby's. You're right where you belong.
Arby's Real Croissant Breakfast.
It says here the temperature on Venus averages 800 degrees.
So let's go to the beach instead.
29 million miles away.
The beach is closer.
Here, finish this off before your ice cubes melt.
Is that what I've been drinking?
Yeah, they improved it.
That's one calorie? Oh, it's got that new sweetener in it.
It's sweeping the planet.
Which planet?
You know, the one with the beach.
Taste improved by Diet Pepsi.
Coach, we all know how tough it is to win in Castle Coliseum in Blacksburg against Tech. It's even tougher in Mid-South Coliseum against Memphis.
Well, we've had a great rivalry with Memphis for years and years. As you well know, Dave, it goes clear back into the Missouri Valley, and it's even escalated, I think, since Coach Kirk has been there, because he was an assistant here. And I think it's a great college rivalry. Anyone that's ever been to one of those games would think it would be lacking in excitement. I mean, the atmosphere, it is stimulating. And it is tough on the road. There's no question about that. But you know what? That's what college basketball is all about. I don't know if we can go to Memphis and beat that team. I have no way to know that. If Billy's 100% healthy and we play really well, we've got a chance. But we'll have to play well to beat them down there. I watched them play Florida State the other night, and they played really well, and Florida State did, and got beat. And I mean, you can play well at a place like that against a team like that, and lose anyway. They've got those two big 7-footers in there now, and they make it very difficult for you to get the ball inside. When you get it in there, they intimidate you and block the shots. They pack their zone in so tight. When they get ahead of you, they go from man to man to zone, and they make it real tough on you. But it's the kind of challenge that I think this team likes, and we're looking forward to it. And if we can have a good shooting night, who knows? We might upset somebody down there. That's certainly what we're going down there to find out.
And we'll all find out better next week as we review the Memphis State game and then Monday night Wright State and Western Kentucky on Wednesday in Freedom Hall. Thanks for being with us.
The Denny Crum Show has been sponsored by Bud Light. The best has a taste all its own, a clean, distinctive taste you'll find in Bud Light. By Great Financial Federal, making it great for you. By Arby's Roast Beef Restaurants in Louisville. Welcome to Arby's. You're right where you belong. By Bluegrass Hardware Stores. When you shop Bluegrass, you're through shopping. And by Pepsi Cola General Bottlers, Louisville, Kentucky. Bottlers of Pepsi Cola, Diet Pepsi, Pepsi Free, Pepsi Light, and Mountain Dew.